shit you gone and that's a fact. I don't really, really feel that bad. Yeah, yeah. Every week is fashion week for me. Wake up, put on all the freshest shit you ever seen. New York, LA, Milan, Italy. I know that you're... Oh, man. What's up, everyone? Oof.
Oh, man.
I got a little echo. Get rid of that. Yeah. We're doing a little better today. Got my coffee here. Probably going to be a little low energy relative to what I normally am, but that's okay. Still definitely some stuff that we can cover. Oh, fuck. Udi, Worth, and Minerheimer is in here. I guess we're all going to have fun staying poor for 2021. It's a sign, people. Yeah, no, I've been speaking with Dan and Rob and all those guys, and you know, I know you guys want more moonshot type options that that you can play in TixWix. That's something that we're working on. You know, we're in the environment where like moonshots do happen. So it's not just like a conversation that, you know, Dan and I need to have, or Dan and Rob need to have, or whatever. You know, it's more of a conversation that, you know, we've actually got to have with the market makers and stuff. Like, these are the guys that are providing these odds. Yeah, the flu sucks. You know, everybody wants to jump to conclusions, coronavirus. Just quick story, because I know nobody actually cares that much. I was, like, totally fine. You know, I went to the doctor for something completely unrelated on... See, I don't even know what fucking day it is right now. What day is it? Thursday. That's how these days have just kind of bled. So I went to the doctor for something completely unrelated on the 29th, and I was bitching, as you guys saw on Twitter, about how long the doctor was taking to see me and how I feel like every time I go to the doctor, it's like that. When I left the doctor, you know, I had planned to do a stream that day, and I was riding the car of my wife because she went with me, and I was... The idea was, hey, on the way home, let's stop and get me an energy drink so, you know, I can be amped for the stream and I can come out with a lot of energy and, you know, we can have a good stream. But in the car, like, I just started, like, shaking. And one thing I noticed at the doctor, by the end of my visit, like, my knees and my ankles and my lower back were just killing me. Like, it was fucking terrible. So I was like, you know, I started shivering and, you know, like literally teeth chattering, like shaking. And, you know, I just told my wife, just drive home. You know, I was like, don't get an energy drink. She was like, are you sure? Like, you know, like you got your stream. And I was like, I don't think the stream's happening. Like something's fucking weird. So, you know, we came home and I remember I came out to my computer to do the stream and I just started violently shivering again. So I was like, holy fuck. So I laid down on the floor of my office. And that wasn't working out. I kept getting colder and colder and colder. I put my jacket on. I kept getting colder. And so then I went to our guest bedroom and I got under a sheet. I had a sweater, a jacket, my jeans on. I got under a sheet, like that little middle blanket that goes on top of the sheet. I'm sure you guys know what I'm talking about. And then a comforter on top of that. And I was just laying there, like shivering my fucking ass off. And finally I managed to go to sleep and I woke up. And when I woke up, my ears hurt, my throat hurt. I had a brutal headache and I wasn't shivering anymore, but you know, we took my temperature. It was high 99s. I would imagine it was probably 100, you know, when I was shivering and all that. But yeah, that was trash. Symptoms wise now, you know, appreciate everybody checking in with me. You know, you'd be surprised at how many friends you don't know you have. You know, when you're going through something, but I had a lot of folks checking with me and I appreciate all that. You know, it makes me feel better that so many people were concerned and all that. Feel a lot better. You know, I had two nights where I slept like 14, 15, 16 hours. Mostly right now, my throat is a little sore and my body hurts a lot and I'm tired and I've got a really, really awful brain fog. And to be honest, no, I wasn't drinking a lot. You know, I'd been in Nashville, Tennessee, over the weekend, But we really didn't drink a lot. You know, we drank one day, really. And even then, you know, I wasn't blackout. You know, I didn't get retarded, so. Anyway, this is going to be a kind of a year-end stream. As I said, you know, I'm probably not going to be as high energy as normal today. I did want to do this for you guys, though. I had a lot of people asking about it and counting on it. And I really want to take this time to kind of reflect on, you know, my year, some lessons I learned, you know, mistakes I made. I'm certainly not perfect. You know, some things that I want to try to be better about, some things I want to try to do better. And I think it's really important for you all to kind of reflect on 2020, you know, and think about your trading year, at least, and think about, you know, what you could have done better. You know, think about the decisions that you made that really hurt you. Think about the decisions that you made that really helped you out. Think about the things that could have been done. And yeah, you know, it's not good to just sit there and dwell on these things forever, of course. But it is good to make note of them, and it is good to actually think about it. And process it. You know, I know a common thing. I do this more than anyone I know, and I'm sure a lot of you do too. But you know, when something's bad or you made a mistake, it's very easy to just kind of put it in the back of your head. And especially, I think with traders, like, we do that a lot. We're very good at taking those bad things and ignoring them. And that's like one of the, you know, like, most psychopathic, like, crazy things in the world to do. But it allows us to continue. You know, somebody will be like, holy shit, you just lost, you know, like, 10 grand on that. Like, how are you even functioning right now? And you're like, oh, no big deal. Like, it is a big deal, though. Like, you're just, you know, you're just kind of putting it in the back of your head. And you're not thinking about it. But it's important. You know, we're moving into 2021. Presumably a very bullish year for crypto. And with that being said, and considering just how crazy 2021 might be, it's good to know what you did well, what you did poorly. It's good to know where you can learn. You know, I certainly have a lot of areas, you know, where I can improve. It's also good to know, just recognize, you know, and be proud of the things you did well, and also, you know, to catalog and know the things you did poorly. Yeah, it's compartmentalizing. You know, with me, I think originally, and this is something that took me a while to realize, because in the past, you know, the token economics weren't, and this is going to be actually my number one mistake, or number one or two, it's up there. Ugh, excuse me. My number one or two mistake for 2020 was not giving enough attention to token economics, because in the past, the token economics really didn't matter. You know, there was this whole notion of FOMO-nomics. You know, it didn't really matter how many users something had, or how hyped something was, or not how hyped something was, sorry. It didn't matter how many users something had, or adoption, or TV, like, none of that really mattered in the past. You know, that's the environment that I grew up in, and for me, that was devastating, because, you know, in DeFi summer, I could have performed a lot better if I hadn't over allocated to MTA, you know, which had all of the classic hallmarks of what I was used to pumping, you know. It had the names, it had the hype, it had the team, it had all of this stuff going for it. But there's just this dark cloud of just the most atrocious token economics that were hanging over MTA the entire time. And by the time that I actually was able to realize that, hey, things have changed, you know, it's not just like this FOMO-nomics kind of environment right now where oh my God, this is hype, you know, we gotta buy it. This is the kind of thing that's gonna pump because it's a narrative that can be sold. Narratives are great, you know, but you gotta really have the full picture now. You gotta have it all going on. And MTA certainly had a lot of those things that in the past, like even when I was looking at things like RSR, which has questionable token economics, let's be honest. RIN, which actually has pretty solid token economics. But even when I was investing in things like RSR and RIN, which, you know, were for me legendary trades, I wasn't even thinking about those things because they didn't matter. Well, they matter now. Unfortunately for me, you know, the token economics of MTA are going to improve soon. I'm still over allocated to it. I will have my revenge on MTA. And fortunately for me, everything that I thought about that team, you know, the people behind it, all of that still held true. You know, they're going to release this new novel automated market making protocol in a bit that I think is going to be a huge deal for stable coins and a huge deal for the protocol as well. But in retrospect, that was just one of the worst moves that I made this year. And it ended up hurting me significantly, not just in terms of, you know, any kind of drawdown or anything like that, but also in terms of opportunity costs. You know, imagine if I had taken what I had put in MTA and I had been concerned about good token economics. And back then, what has good token economics? Well, you look at things like YFI, you know, and it's like, damn, you know, it's in retrospect, it's so obvious. But if my focus had evolved at that point and I was able to see this new paradigm shift and I was able to recognize that the token economics actually matter a lot now, I think I'd be in a lot better place than I would now. And yeah, I mean, DT, DCTR, you guys have got to get better names that I can pronounce. I mean, you're 100% right. Like with RSR, like that, the token economics, like RSR number was just going up because it was hype as fuck, you know? Peter Thiel, Coinbase Ventures, like, it could be huge, right? But we weren't even thinking about the token economics. It wasn't even, it didn't even factor into that equation. YFI is good token economics because there wasn't this inflation. If you think about MTA and the way it's inflating right now, there has to be a lot of market demand to counter the amount of inflation that's ongoing. And that inflation doesn't matter so much. I lost six figures on MTA. I'm not afraid to say it, and you know, it just is what it is. But I lost much more than that in opportunity costs. But if a token is and look at Curve, for example. And here's the thing, you know, like, even then, you know, I was looking at things like Curve and I was like, well, the token economics could be a lot worse. Like, it's not the worst token economics, but it's up there, you know, it's pretty fucking bad. So, I mean, really the whole thing for me is just knowing that, you know, what a colossal fuck up that was for the way I played 2020. And just knowing that I could have played 2020 a lot better. But the important thing is here that we not beat ourselves up too much over that. You know, and that we learn from that and we move forward. You know, presumably, presumably we're going to have a lot more opportunities in 2021. So as long as we can learn and probably bigger opportunities than we had in this little DeFi summer, right? Everybody's fucking rich now. I mean, if you look at the money, when money rotates from Bitcoin to other things, I mean, we've got people that are rich as fucking hell now, and they're gonna wanna buy some of this shit that you're in, hopefully. We'll discuss that in a little bit. The main thing here is being able to learn, being able to accept that you're not perfect, and being able to understand that, you know, while you may have made a mistake, that it's not the end of the world, you know, that there is hope for you. Now, my second, yeah, let's talk some Badger. I think Badger's gonna moon. Badger's some good shit. And we'll talk about the token economics of Rook as well. And, you know, I also have a theory I just posted on Twitter about Rook, that Rook could be using RenVM. For the hiding game, I mean, God damn it, excuse me, guys. Ugh, my head is just pounding right now. Let me get some more coffee in me. I've got a little Nespresso. I made myself it's not a cold brew, but I made myself an iced coffee. And I'm hoping this is going to get me through about an hour of this. But you guys just bear with me. I mean, at a certain point, though, like, here's a huge issue. You know what? Let me discuss my second biggest failure, and then I'll discuss my third biggest failure. My second biggest failure was not rotating to Bitcoin. You know, and a lot of that, you know, one could say, how could you have known that, you know, when these DeFi things topped out, after what's actually a relatively short bull run, how could you have known that the move would be to rotate entirely into Bitcoin? How could you have known that this DeFi stuff was going to go negative 90%? And those are valid points, you know, but at the same time, this isn't my first rodeo. You know, I should have known and I should have acted on the fact that the money does rotate from sector to sector. And I think the important thing to note on that is that the money always rotates from sector to sector. And while for me, you know, I'd be sitting with probably 5x more money than I have right now, maybe even more, you know, if I had rotated into, you know, Bitcoin, as some people did. I mean, fucking, to be honest, if you look at like guys like Three Arrow, like these guys are literally calling everything perfectly. It kind of makes you wonder, you know, are they the puppet masters, you know, pulling all the strings? That's great news on Dusk. Three Arrows literally called everything perfectly. They called the DeFi perfectly. DeFi Summer perfectly. They called the rotation to Bitcoin perfectly. They called what's happening to alts right now perfectly. You know, Kyle called, or I think it was Kyle, kept saying 75% dominance. It's in my head, I was like, nah, bro, like, no way. But he, once again, like, they were fucking right. The important lesson to learn is not, like, dude, you fucking suck, like, because of what you could have done. The important lesson to learn here is that the money does rotate from sector to sector, and that hasn't changed. It's not just like all the money's in Bitcoin and it's never going anywhere else. I mean, when these guys start talking about alts, like, you probably just need to go balls fucking deep. Yeah, yesterday you said all alts are not made equal, and I think what he meant by that, you know, people love to take what Three Arrows say, and they love to, you know, extrapolate these grand theories of, you know, oh, I think that they're talking about my bag, or I think they mean this, or I think they mean that. But the reality is when they say something like that, it's just shit posts, okay? All it means is that not all alts are created different, and it means that your bag is down negative 90% and I'm holding synthetics and I'm still rich. Pretty sure that's all that means. And see, you know, I did say some things like, you know, rotate, pull from the old dead legacy bags and rotate into Bitcoin. You know, I wasn't in those old legacy bags and you know, I didn't rotate into Bitcoin at all, which was, you know, it was a monumental error on my part. And not one that I'm paying for, I will say, but really paying for opportunity costs. I've had to do a lot of flip-flopping and things to make up for that. Yeah, give me just a second, guys. And I apologize. I'm really trying to make this as good as I can for you. Get my bearings. So taking what we learned from lesson number two, that the money does rotate eventually, the money's gonna rotate. And you need to start asking yourself, you know, where's the money gonna go? You know, well, people have just gotten hilariously rich on Bitcoin, and we have historical precedent that says when people get hilariously rich on Bitcoin and the money rotates, that they go to altcoins, right? Now, here's an interesting thing, here's an interesting thing to note. When you look at that top 10, there's still not one DeFi protocol there. Not one. Which is really interesting. And I think that that's something that's going to change in 2021. I think DeFi still gets a lot of hype. I don't know if you guys knew this, but, you know, if you think about it, you know, there are big names outside of crypto in general talking about DeFi. You know, one of those big names is Nabil. I mean, I know, you know, we like to joke on Nabil and he tweets a bunch of stuff that's, you know, it's just clout posting and goober posting and whatever. But the reality of the situation is that you've got a lot of VC types like Nabel that are looking for the next big thing. And they're looking for where, you know, they can see outsized returns, and they're looking for where they can allocate money and you know, really see explosive growth. And that field is DeFi. I've mentioned this before, you know, and we see people like to joke on Brad Mills. He's actually one of my oldest crypto friends, and him and I get along fantastically. And you might see me ribbing at him on Twitter or whatever. But he's super smart, and we talk, you know, almost every day. We're that close of friends. And one of the things he likes to post about on Twitter, you know, that I like to give him a hard time about, is he'll post, "Oh my God, it costs $60 to make a trade on Uniswap." Naval? I just call him Naval, like a fucking belly button. I mean, you can call him whatever you want. You know, I think this is one of those rare instances where I'm just gonna take my Alabama pass. I'm gonna take my Alabama pass on that, and I'm gonna call him Naval, like a belly button. Oh God. sorry guys. Oof. Anyway. The money's gonna rotate. And you have to start thinking about where it's gonna rotate. Now, with that being said, now is really kind of like the time of maximum opportunity, you know, to be getting in some of these plays. And now is the time where, for many, it's just inconceivable to even think about rotating, you know, from Bitcoin to any kind of altcoin. But I'm looking at things that are literally, you know, primitive layers. And let's talk about primitives for a second. You know, let's look at all of the biggest DeFi protocols in existence right now. Your Aave, your Compound, Curve, huge, all of these. You know, what's YFI? What synthetics? What's the one thing that these protocols all share in common? These protocols are all base layers for other people to build on. They're primitives, okay? I think, I think that investing in things that are potentially primitives themselves is going to net you the highest return of 2021. And if you look at things, you know, the things that I'm in that I think could be like that, you know, MPH, 88 MPH is a great example of that. You have to look at it and you got to say, but Messi, there's, you know, only 4 million of TVL here. You know, what's going on? Like this doesn't make any sense. How could this be the next big thing if it's just a $4 million market cap? Well, if you look at the early days of YFI, it was kind of the same thing. You know, you have this situation where if people had realized just how big it was going to be at that point in time, then it wouldn't have been super cheap for anybody to buy. If you look at Hedgic, has already grown a bit, but Hedgic's another one, you know, and when you look at Hedgic is a base layer, and you look at things that are being built by Hedgic and Hedgic supporters, Whiteheart, for one, you know, Hedgic's a base layer for other people to build on, and Whiteheart's super cool because, you know, Whiteheart allows you to automatically hedge positions that you buy, and it's going to route all of that through Hedgic. So being exposed to Hedgic, you know, you get exposure to literally everything that builds on Hedgic. Just like with synthetics, just like with Compound, just like with anything else like that. So that's really the goal here, is to identify those opportunities. And not just to identify those opportunities, but like I said earlier, we're looking for good token economics here. You know, Rook is another one. You know, we wanted to talk about token economics. Well, Rook, if you look at the Block Explorer, and you know what? And you know, dude, please don't pump Hedgic because I'm literally dying to get another Hedgic lot right now. I love Rari governance token, but I guess I have weak hands. You guys shook me out. Look, I can take pain, but if you guys do what you did to Rari governance token to a bag I'm holding, like, you're gonna get rid of me. Like, you just are. Now, Abe has got great token economics. Yeah, guys, Zlot is super cool because if you think about it, to actually stake your Hedgic, you have to have 888,000 Hedgic, okay, for one lot. And you can pick to put that lot on Ethereum or Bitcoin. Now, if I wanted, I could unstake. I've got an Ethereum lot right now, and I've got my reasons for that, and I'll discuss. But if I wanted, I could unstake my Ethereum lot, and I believe I could stake it as a Bitcoin lot. But here's the thing about Zlot, okay? Not everybody has 888,000 Hedgic. Right now, 888,000 Hedgic is about $100,000. Not everybody's got $100,000 to put into Hedgic. I mean, let's be honest here. Let's be real. So Zlot actually allows you to, it's a staking pool. It allows you to come in, and by owning that Zlot, you get exposure to Hedgic, and you get exposure to all of those people that can't afford to buy their own Hedgic lot. So if I was to acquire a big piece of Zlot, that's, you know, fantastic for me because there's only a fixed supply, and the more people that come into Zlot to stake their Hedgic that can't afford that full lot, and trust me, in the future, like, if Hedgic makes it and it moons, one of those lots could cost $1 million. Even a guy with $100,000 might not be able to afford that full Hedgic lot. So, and if I'm exposed to something like Zlot, I'm exposed to all of those people, all of that Hedgic that comes in stakes from people that can't afford to buy that whole lot. And trust me, there's going to be a lot of people that want to stake their Hedgic, that want to be exposed to Hedgic, that aren't going to be able to afford a full lot. And Zlot has fantastic token economics. So Zlot's something I'm very interested in. There's only 8,888 of them. You know, Whiteheart is another thing. And I was disappointed because, you know, I looked at the Whiteheart contract and I knew early on, and I didn't know if Molly had worked some kind of black magic in here. And this is why I didn't talk about it in public, because I would just feel terrible if I walked people into a situation to where they just got fucked off the jump, you know, because of some theory that I had. But with Whiteheart, you know, I pushed in a nice chunk of Ethereum into the IBCO. And I was thinking to myself, I was like, you know what, if there's not some black magic, you know, whitelist here, and I am able to get a piece of this, then there's great token economics here. And then I get to collect fees on all the activity that Whiteheart generates for Hedgic. And I own a Hedgic lot, and now I own, you know, some Whiteheart. So this could really be something, right? But here's the catch. Somehow, some way, Whiteheart managed to pull in like 14,000 Ethereum. It was way oversubscribed because I was like, you know, I was almost thinking like I could go into this, you know, maybe a few thousand Ethereum comes in. I've got a nice chunk of the supply and it, you know, goes 3 or 4x after that. And maybe I could sell it and buy a couple of Hedgic lots. You know, that was my thought going into it. But what actually happened was I went to bed thinking that, and I woke up the next day and like 6,000 more Ethereum had piled in. I was extremely diluted. You know, the market cap was way higher than it should have been for something that didn't even have a product out yet, that's not even working. And I bailed on it for maybe 30 to 50% gain. Still a gain. You can't complain. But it wasn't the plan. That's okay. KP3R. Great token economics, and you need to understand the use case for KP3R. People don't understand, it's like a cron job for DeFi. Think about this. DeFi has all this stuff going on in it, right? There's a liquidation that needs to be handled over here, you know? There's a settlement that needs to happen over here. This needs to happen over here. A rebase needs to happen over there. That thing needs to rebase. There's all of these functions, and all of these functions on Ethereum, they're manual contract calls, which means somebody has to go in and actually, boop, you know, connect with Web3. They've got to execute that contract call. They've got to pay the gas, and they've got to facilitate that function. But the issue with that is there was nothing that existed to actually promote efficiency in DeFi and automation of DeFi. KP3R promotes the automation of DeFi. And KP3R is, I believe, a work token, you know, which I think somebody mentioned earlier. Yeah, I mean, DeFi needed cron job functionality. As a user in chat is saying, LWW515, you can't have all the actions just be user-driven. So KP3R was a natural fit. And KP3R is huge because it's literally all this new shit that's released in DeFi. It's not going to be any different. All of a sudden, all of these actions that take place, they're not going to be automatic. That's just not how it works. KP3R allows for the automation of all of this shit. So, you know, I'm a dev. I want to have a brand new badass rebase project. I can go in to KP3R and I can set it up so that all of that is automated and taken care of by somebody that's willing to do that work for a little bit of reward. And I just don't have to worry about it anymore. You know, it's incentivized, it's out there. It's KP3R is a fantastic project, and KP3R is, it's honestly kind of a base layer in that regard for a lot of other things in DeFi. It's you know, it's a critical component, a critical building block in DeFi. Is there anywhere you can watch this as a VOD? Well, you can watch this after the stream is over. You can watch the stream. It's recorded. You know, I'm also recording this locally. We'll submit it to our Hxro Labs techs, and they'll They will, sorry guys, getting hit by the brain fog really hard. They will upload it to our YouTube channel. And I'm getting hit with the heat really hard now. I'm having like a hot flash, fuck. So anyway, you know, Rook, from a token economic standpoint, you know, you've got this initial circulating supply of 1 million Rook, right? And this arbitrage mining thing is going to be going on for one more month. That's like, I've described Rook before in the past as an ongoing ICO. If you think back to the day, like EOS, you know, when EOS had their ICO, you had like a year to contribute to the ICO. Rook's kind of the same way, except for the ICO price of Rook is, you know, purely determined by demand. Now, who fulfills that demand? Keepers. What is a keeper? A lot of people have asked, what is a keeper? Well, keepers are the guys on Ethereum that are in the mempool that are carrying out these tasks in DeFi, that are arbing this, you know, that are arbing from this to that, that are keeping. Basically, it's a market efficiency thing in a lot of regards. Keepers are the guys that are carrying out the liquidations. There's all of this opportunity on Ethereum and probably in other upcoming blockchains as well that's referred to as MEV. And I think that's, excuse my brain fog right now, but I think it stands for minor extractable value. Now, keepers are guys, they're coders, right? They're Solidity devs. Right now, these guys that are participating in the Rook ICO, every day, there's 1,550-ish, and I say ish because the number's slightly more than that. It might be 1,555.33 or something like that, but it's around that number. There's that many Rooks up for grabs per day. And now you look at the Rook treasury and every day you're seeing, wow, you know, Rook treasury grew by $80,000 today. The next day, wow, you know, Rook Treasury had a $50,000 day. Then the next day, wow, you know, Rook Treasury did $120,000 today. All that is, okay, is these guys are coming in, and it's almost like practice, you know, for interacting with these keeper pools, the liquidity pools. They're coming in, they're borrowing, you know, one GUI, and this is how this is going to work in the future, right? But they're borrowing some amount, and then they're returning more than they borrowed. And what this is, and what it does, is it simulates a keeper carrying out some kind of arb or whatever, you know, by taking a flash loan from the liquidity pools on Rook, keeper DAO, and then returning that plus some of the profits to the DAO. So we know that there's a fixed amount being emitted per day right now, and that will continue for the next month, okay? Now there's more than just that 1,550 or so emitted per day. The liquidity providers in these pools are actually getting Rooks as well. Now what they're paying is opportunity costs. They're not paying real money, they're just paying opportunity costs. But the keepers, right, the guys that are actually arbitrage mining this are mining this shit for a certain value. If you think about it, think about like with Bitcoin and you look at the miners on Bitcoin and you say, what is the cost to mine one Bitcoin? You know, that's an important metric in Bitcoin, right? Because you'll look at the cost of mine Bitcoin, and let's say that cost is $18,000 now. Well, theoretically, you could kind of imagine that as a floor because, you know, optimally, the people mining Bitcoin wouldn't sell for a loss, right? You know, they're mining it either for an immediate flip, right? Because they can mine it at 18 and sell it for 29, which is something that happens very frequently, or they're mining it to speculate. You know, they might have been mining Bitcoin ever since Bitcoin was $6,000 and they plan on selling it at some number higher. That's exactly what's happening with Keeper DAO right now. So think about this. Let's say $100,000, and you can calculate this yourself. You know, you can add up all the numbers yourself, but hypothetically, let's say $100,000 comes into the Rook Treasury in one day. You take 100,000 divided by 1550, 1550, and that would give you a price of $64.50 per Rook that day. That's the cost of mine. Now, you look at Rook right now at around $80 and you think, $80 Rook, it's been here for a minute. And then you look at the Treasury and consistently, day by day, into the Treasury, people are still mining Rook for whatever reason. We've just outlined those reasons, either to, you know, buy and sell and capture that difference to, you know, instantly arbit between their cost and the market, or to buy and hold because these keepers are gonna need to bond Rook, okay? And we can go over that in a bit too. They're gonna have to bond Rook to participate in the coordination game, which is gonna cause a lot of lockup for Rook. So that's one thing that they could be doing. They could be mining it now at $60 because they wanna speculate on it. But the important thing to note here is that every single fucking day after day after day, you've got these big brains that are coming in that are willing to pay $60 plus for Rooks, and they're exchanging liquid assets for them. They're exchanging Ethereum, they're exchanging Bitcoin, they're exchanging stable coins. They are willing to pay this price for these Rooks for whatever reason. And then you look at the market price and you say, well, the market is pricing Rook at $80 right now. That might be a good snag. It's slightly over the price that these keepers are paying, but hey, maybe I'm not this galaxy brain. I don't have the ability to make these contracts and participate in this. And even then, you know, you could run into situations where, let's say these keepers get competitive and now one day, you know, whereas 100,000 has been coming in steadily and they all understand that, hey, you submit that much, I submit this much, you know, at the end of the day, we all get this pretty good price for Rook. Let's say a new guy comes onto the scene and says, you know, I want a fucking piece of this too. and I'm gonna pay $20,000 a day into this for the next month, and you know, I'm gonna get mine. Well, now you have $120,000 coming into the treasury, right? And we take $120,000 and divide that by 1550. And now they're paying, you know, $77 per rook. So that's how that works. That's going to be ongoing for the next month. Now, token economics wise, there's two properties that I like about Rook. And one thing you have to remember is that the guys behind Rook are two of the biggest VC firms in crypto, period. You've got Pantera, or not Pantera, you've got Polychain, and you've got Three Arrows, okay? Which they both own. I think Three Arrows has 20,000 rooks, and Polychain has 100,000, which is very impressive. The team owns a very, very large portion of rooks as well, which are to be considered in circulation. But the reality here is that the circulating supply, those guys aren't selling their rooks, okay? You go ahead and take that 100, you take that 20, and you take the team's token, and you remove them from the markets. These guys have rooks because rook is needed to participate in the coordination game. Not only that, but the white paper describes a situation to where I could delegate my rook to a keeper somehow, some way, and you know, and I could enable a particular keeper in the coordination game. And maybe, I don't know the details of this or how it's gonna work, but maybe because I'm bonding my rook to him, maybe he's gonna pay me a part of his profits, you know, for the privilege of elevating his status in the coordination game. So here's the thing, the rook supply is not capped, but the inflation is quite high right now. You know, we're emitting a certain amount of rook right now, and that is something that we're very well aware of until the end of the month. Now, in a perfect world, you know, we wouldn't have to incentivize anyone, but rook actually does have a use. You know, there is going to be a lot, an artificial constriction of the rook supply from people bonding their rooks. And I would imagine that the people that are making this project, the Ren guys, you know, Amber Group, I would imagine that those same people are planning on participating in the coordination game. Now, I'm also speculating the hiding game is going to be routed through Ren VM in some shape, form, or fashion. I mean, that's just me putting one and one together, and one plus one equals two. You know, you look at who's behind Rook, it's the Ren guys. Well, what is Ren? Well, Ren is very well known for Ren BTC and Ren ZEC and Ren this and Ren that, right? Trustlessly wrapping your assets and having them on the Ethereum blockchain for use in DeFi is a big deal. But Ren VM is capable of a lot more than that. And I do believe Rook is an application that's being built on Ren VM. I could be totally wrong in that. But very soon, and I believe this is going to be after, you know, this ICO phase of sorts is going to be over. You know, the governance for Rook will emerge, and we will be able to vote on future emissions of the Rook protocol. And I would highly doubt, especially considering that, you know, the people that own Rook are the guys that have been paying, you know, $60+ for Rook for months into this. I highly doubt that all these people that hold Rook, that have Rook, are going to be voting on governance parameters, you know, inflation parameters that don't make any sense and that are bad from a token economic standpoint, especially considering that the guys behind Rook are token economics pros. You know, we're not fucking around here. So just thoughts on that. You know, I am bullish on Rook. I do think that Rook will continue to be a good buying opportunity. You know, anytime it falls in maybe the $80 range, if you get it in the 70s, that's fantastic. But for the next month, you have to remember that just like with Bitcoin, there's miners that can come in and mine it at, you know, 10,000 or 12 or whatever, and immediately sell it for that profit. You know, why would they not? How could you blame them? There's going to continue to be people like that for Rook for the next month. And what I think for the next 2 weeks, I wouldn't imagine you see much out of Rook. Maybe even the next three. But at a certain point, because a lot of people know this and a lot of people are watching this, at a certain point in time, Rook's going to get marked up. Maybe 200, maybe 300. Who knows? But it's going to be marked up because people are going to start pricing in the future, you know, foreseeably, what would be the future inflation of Rook, the future use cases. You know, the Rook team has been very quiet. We'll start finding out more details about that. And as this arbitrage mining phase comes to a conclusion, as the majority of Rook inflation for the year, you know, has already occurred, has already taken place, you know, I would expect the price to mark up significantly. Just knowing, it's almost like this. Imagine somehow, some way, or think about it like a Bitcoin halving even. It's a supply shock. You know, when Bitcoin halves, it pumps into the halving. Well, why? People are pricing in the supply shock. You know, Rook is not gonna be any different than that. So I'm still super bullish on Rook. You know, it's gonna be hard holding Rook for the next month, especially if we start seeing some other things popping off, you know, and other things start getting some momentum. Really interesting to watch. Keep your eyes on it. Hopefully everybody here understands what I've spoken about. They understand how it works. And also understand this. But Messi, three arrows, they've got 20,000 rooks. You know, Polychain, they have 100,000 rooks. Well, think about this. What if Three Arrows and Polychain are planning on participating in the coordination game, and now they've got a shitload of rooks to bind to their position in the coordination game? You know, well, good for them. You know, they're able to participate at a high level and reap the rewards of that without really ever having to sell. Now, we do have this, you know, we do have the treasury of Rook as well, right? So another thing to note about that is, you know, the treasury has over $6 million of stuff in it right now. Rook is a governance token. We can vote to do whatever we want with the treasury. These guys may never have to sell their rooks to even get paid on that. You know, if the token economics in Rook are super solid, if Rook is going to make it, if it works, if it's hype, if this is game changing, as you know it could be, why would they sell it? You know, when they've got something that literally, you know, if you think about this, okay, I can buy, well, I'm trying to think of a good example, something with profit sharing, you know, okay, how about this? Let's say there's 100 Hedgic lots, right? And I buy 10 of those 100 lots. I get 10% of the profits that Hedgic platform is generating. Now, Hedgic generates more profits, I get more money. Simple as that. Rook is different, okay? Because Rook, the addressable market isn't just like Hedgic, how many people are trading options? How much volume are they doing? The addressable market is all MEV on the Ethereum blockchain. Fucking all of it. All of it. So if you just think about that, It's greater than literally everything in terms of profit capture, because it benefits from all activity on the Ethereum blockchain. As DeFi in general grows, Rook has more profit opportunities. So when I say that Rook could be the biggest thing in DeFi, this is why I say that. You're not just confined to the growth of one protocol. Rook gives you exposure to the growth of every single DeFi protocol. All of it. All of it. I think not having any Rook is potentially insane. And I do believe that at some point, you know, people will look back and retrospect on Rook, just like they look back and retrospect on Wi-Fi, Aave, Synthetics, and they'll say, damn, you know, could there have been a more obvious play? And I think the answer to that is no. Even with things like MPH, you know, I can buy a bunch of MPH and, you know, I can be entitled to, you know, I love MPH because you, like Hedgic, by staking your MPH, you know, you get 100% of the protocol or the protocol fees generated and the profit goes to people that hold MPH. MPH is one of those base layer protocols to where other people can build on. And you're already seeing some people building on that right now. one, DBase. You know, I did see I connected Spotaboom, the founder of Badger, who's a good buddy of mine, with McFly of MPH yesterday, and I know they are chatting about working together, which could be huge. The more people that build on MPH, the more people will come, the more TVL, the more value accrues to the token. But once again, you've got a token with good token economics, solid value accrual to the token, which is something that really not many people are doing well at all. You know, like I said, with Hedgic, it's amazing because I can actually stake my Hedgic and I have ownership in that protocol and in those fees that the protocol generates. MPH is the same way. Rook, I have entitlement to, I mean, hypothetically, all of the fucking MEV on Ethereum. Like, what? That could be a big fucking deal. But here's the thing. So, and that's a good point because Flashbots has had a couple of posts and, you know, and things that they've shared, especially with, you know, transactions being mined for zero gas, you know, transactions that the miners are extracting, mining themselves. How do you combat that? Well, that's where the hiding game comes into play. And you think about a lot of this TVL in DeFi, and you have to wonder, where does that come from? Where's this TVL coming from? That's where it's important to look at. Wait a minute. Who has an extremely large stake in Rook? Polychain. Three Arrows. Right? Now, Polychain and Three Arrows also own a significant portion of the TVL and DeFi. So let's say that these two guys, just these two guys, start routing their liquidity, their whatever, their loans through the hiding game, through these specialized contracts. Well, we're right then and there. That's a huge chunk of MEV that's effectively been taken offline, that's been hidden from the miners. Also, if you think about it, you know, if you're bullish on Rook, it may be pretty smart to speculate on Ren as well. You know, just to think that Rook could be a killer app built on RenVM. At least the hiding game part of it. So keep an eye on Rook over the next month. That's how much longer that this arbitrage mining phase is going to occur. And right now, it hasn't started heating up yet because, you know, it's like, think about this, you know, a month before Bitcoin's halving, you know, people are talking about the halving, people are knowing about the halving, but they're kind of thinking to themselves and they're like, well, you know, like when's the halving pump? Sometimes the pump comes after the halving. Sometimes, you know, you get a little pump leading into it. It's coming, just a matter of time. Rook, be patient, and I would not advise buying Rook unless you plan on actually seeing it through this month, seeing what happens after this month, January. Because if alts start popping off in January, they might, and I'll discuss that in a moment, you're going to potentially say, fuck, you know, why am I in Rook? You know, this is going 2x and that's gone 3x and this has done that and that's done that and my Rook isn't doing anything. You know, because I've got these ARB miners that are keep crushing the price every time that I increase the spread. It's something to keep an eye on. Yeah, DHT, D-Hedge, super cool. I don't necessarily like the token economics on D-Hedge. As I've said before, one of my biggest failures in 2020 was failing to account for token economics, and I'm not planning on making that mistake moving forward. Rook has presumably fantastic token economics, to be determined though. You have to have a little faith there in the governance process. MPH, fantastic token economics and value accrual, which is another thing that's very important. Value accrual. Is your token a worthless governance token or is it not so worthless? Is there actually a value accrual mechanism to where, you know, holding this token is beneficial for me for other reasons than just number go up, right? Yeah, I've looked at Saffron. I like Acropolis and CVP. I used to have both of those, but I don't anymore just because I rotated to things that fit my new thesis when I really sat down and thought about how I want to play this and what the best way to play this and what could give me the best gains. Very, very bullish on Insure for the month of January. I think Insure is going to blow minds. I don't have any just because I got shaken out. But Insure is partnered with MPH. Cover is now partnered with MPH. You know, they're going to be offering Cover and Insure products on MPH for the people that that get there. I'm in the MPH Discord, and I browse it every day. But the token economics on MPH are fucking awesome. Now, okay, guys, look, I just want to be very clear about this. I'm still bullish on Hxro. You know, I had to sell Hxro. People, maybe you're angry about that. Maybe you don't understand why. I still plan on interviewing Ping. He's one of my favorite devs in DeFi. One of the biggest lessons I learned from 2020 was that the things that really move are projects where the devs are iterating very quickly. If you're not innovating and iterating on your ideas quickly enough, somebody else will do it, and they will do it faster than you. With Hxro, my main issue is that they move very slowly. Hxro went up a lot. There was a lot of hype around iGain. And I believe that if iGain had been released, you know, Hxro could be accruing serious value right now. Unfortunately, you know, iGain was pushed. iGain was hyped. The trigger for me to actually exit was when Ping released the GitHub for some hot upcoming product releases. And there was zero mention of iGain, you know, which had really been the sole reason that a lot of people had bought into Hxro. I was under the impression, you know, based on interviews and such, that iGain was slated for release sometime in December. And instead, we got some kind of prediction tool and an automated market maker that is not live yet. I'm very bullish on Hxro, and I know Ping's going to kill it in the long run. And if I am able to maybe get some serious profits somewhere else, I would seriously consider Hxro as a prime candidate for me to get back into. I'm happy to get back into Hxro at any time. I have nothing bad to say about Ping. You know, I wish that he was moved a little faster. I wish he was a little bit more transparent. But at the end of the day, he's a wonderful dev. He's no BS, and he gets it done, and he's respected, and, you know, that's just is what it is. Now, I don't want to just sit here and stream forever. Let's look at some Nansens. You know, I know a lot of you guys don't have Nansen. It's really expensive. You know, maybe I can do you a favor and check out the Nansen on your favorite token. That'll give me a little break from talking. I am getting a little delirious right now. But yeah, I'll check out some Nansens for you guys, and I think that'll be a good note to end it on. You know, maybe you guys, it'll help your plans out to see, you know, who's buying what and, you know, if things are being accumulated, dumped, et cetera, et cetera. So let me get Nansen pulled up. You know, I'll get this screen switched over. All right. Good old Nansen. We'll start out with a Nansen for the things that I'm in. I mean, Nansen's expensive. It is. Yeah. Well, I'll try to check out as many Nansens as I can for you guys. You know, I'm not gonna be here for fucking an hour checking out Nansens. I think the total market cap is this cycle. To be honest, I haven't even thought about it. I don't know. Okay, token god mode. Oh, fuck, I didn't even get to talk about Badger. Okay, so I know a lot of you might be following what you believe to be my wallet. Full transparency, I've always been very transparent about what I'm in, what I'm doing. For the better or the worst, okay? Right now, I like Rook. I like MPH. I like Hedgic. I like MTA. As I discussed earlier in the stream, MTA's token economics still suck, but I'm just kind of in it. And I'm optimistic on MTA just because I know the emissions are actually going to be under control pretty soon. And also because of what they're doing. You know, they're pushing some really cool products, and I think MTA could be one of those primitive base layers, you know, a lot of people build on. Something else to note about MTA is the VCs are not selling anymore, which is why the prices stopped going down. You know, a lot of these VCs are just stacking tokens now. So, you know, we'll see what happens with that. I think a lot of those guys already got their pound of bananas shorting the shit out of it on the way down. So we'll see what happens. You know, I'm not saying you should buy MTA at all. It's like I said, good token economics are not something MTA is in possession of right now. MPH, I'm in because it could be a primitive base layer for other people to build on. It already is a primitive base layer. Other people are building on it. And the market cap right now is around 4 to 5 million for the circulating supply. A very good value to get in. It's got value accrual mechanisms built into the token. Love it. Hedgic. Galaxy Brain Dev. Hedgic's another primitive. Tons of people are building on Hedgic. You've got Z options upcoming. You've got Whiteheart upcoming. Hedgic already has mechanisms to allow plebs to stake. Good token economics, value accrual. Hedgic's got it all. Love Hedgic. I'm a believer in the Hedgic Citadel. I would love to have more Hedgic. But once again, are there other opportunities? Okay. Here's another thing. Here's the third biggest mistake that I made. And I think this is actually a recent mistake. I was looking out into the DeFi scape, right? And I saw so many things that I wanted to be in. Oh my God, that looks great. That looks great. That looks great. And I thought to myself, I'm going to get a little bit of exposure in all of them. That was a flaw, and I shouldn't have done that. In retrospect, the thing to do would have been to make more concentrated bets on the things that had that fast iteration, good token economics, value accrual to the token, but could potentially be base layers. There's not as many of those out there, and I think that they're higher probability bets, and I should have gone bigger on them. You know, you guys saw I was in that, and I had decent sized bags in them, right? But I was too spread out. Which, you know, for me, I know better. I knew better when I was doing it. I don't know why I did it, but I did it. You know, I just saw, I was looking at the market caps and I was looking at these projects and looking at these innovations and I was like, well, fuck, you know, like, why wouldn't I need to be exposed here, here, and here? When I should have really just said, you know, like, dude, you don't need 12 bags. What's wrong with you? I've never, ever made good money having 12 bags, never. All of my biggest wins were things that I became a community member in that I really did believe in, that I held through the pain, through the triumphs, that I saw something that other people didn't see and I was early. RIN and RSR are fantastic examples of that. Even looking way back to 2016, Decred was one of my biggest ones ever, and that's a prime example of that as well. If it ain't broke, don't fix it. The issue with being in so many bags like that is you reach a point of diminishing returns, to where you would have actually performed a lot better having much larger, more concentrated bets, and just one of them takes off and you're set. Like, imagine just being in four things and one of those things is 25% of your portfolio and one of those things is the next YFI or something like that. Could be a lot better for you. So that was an issue for me. MTA, shitty token economics, but artificial constriction of supply has always been something that I've been big on everything I've ever been in. RIN, lockup, through staking nodes for RenVM. RSR not so much, right? But even Decred had a staking mechanism where you actually, when you purchased tickets, you were actually bonded, you were locked into that. MPH has the staking and value accrual. Actual protocol fees are paid to people that are staking their MPH, okay? And I've actually spoken with McFly. We're gonna have him on sometime soon. We'll go over MPH in detail for those of you that don't understand. Hedgic, I don't know if I'll ever get fucking Molly on here, but she's brilliant and I love her. Her or him or it, I don't know, you know, to be determined. You know, maybe Molly's hard, who knows? Hedgic, MPH, MTA, Rook, Badger. Now, Badger. Badger scares me. Badger also amazes me at what they're doing. If you look at anything else like Badger in the past, anything ever like Badger in the past, it's failed. Ever. Why has it failed? Because there was actually no value built into the protocol beyond just being a yield aggregator or a, you know, a way for people that are already rich to come in and get richer. Now, one of the things that Badger did that I think from the jump set it apart from all these other things is they came in humble. They made connections. They embraced open source development and they fed these developers. They made an enormous donation to Gitcoin to support a lot of this open source innovation that we all benefit and profit from. They got in bed with all those brilliant YFI devs and devs from over here and over there. And, oh, you're building, we want to work with you, was the attitude. I mean, they didn't say no to anyone, which is amazing because with their airdrop, they literally gave fat stacks of tokens to all of the people that have been building in DeFi from the jump, you know, that have been using DeFi. And they brought all of these people into their community. It's almost like the Borg. They assimilated all of these brilliant people into the community who were grateful for what Badger had done, that owned a stake in this now, and they wanted to build for Badger. Now, Badger being a Bitcoin DAO is, you know, that's fantastic. That's great. You know, that's not necessarily innovative or unique in itself, but what is innovative about Badger is that Badger's not a one-stop shop. I believe Badger is doing something they're gonna allow you to mint some kind of stable coin based on your staked Badger and the value associated with that and your liquidity that you're providing in Badger. So you really can be exposed to Badger and never have to move at all. You know, just mint some stable coins and get popping, you know, get out there, get to work. Super cool, the Dig coin that they're gonna be releasing soon. The Dig product is super cool as well. Dig is a elastic supply cryptocurrency that is going to be pegged to the price of BTC that they're distributing to the people that have been building, working, staking, using Badger, which is really cool. And it's they're learning from things like dynamic set dollar, empty set dollar, basis cash. And they're going to be building in these next generation stabilization mechanisms into Badger or into Dig, which is really cool as well. If you look at Badger, there's 500 million TVL there, all Bitcoin, which is just, that's mind-boggling to me, the amount of growth that Badger DAO has seen. So far, so good. When I said it makes me nervous looking at that kind of TVL, just because when you have that kind of TVL, surely, you know, bad actors are plotting and they're looking for ways to come in and take that. They're looking for ways to exploit that. But, you know, people say it's annoying because I've got to take my I've got to take my liquidity and then I've got to wrap it and then I've got to stake it. Well, they've actually borrowed a lot of this stuff from synthetics, which are absolutely bulletproof contracts. And they've used those contracts and their deployments. So I'm optimistic about Badger just because there's 21 million Badger, just like there's 21 million Bitcoin. So there's scarcity There are mechanisms that are built into Badger, such as DIG, to where we can continue to incentivize Badger stakers, liquidity providers, et cetera, even after the Badger supply has run out. Badger is generating a lot of real revenue, which is being fed into a DAO that is controlled by the people staking Badger. You know, super bullish on Badger. I think that Badger may be the first thing of its kind that actually works. Now that is to be determined, you know, and a lot of that is on, you know, the backs. The future of Badger is on the backs of some of the most brilliant minds in DeFi who are all aligned and all interested in seeing this work out. Badger's awesome, okay? And I'm not quite sure. Let's pull up a Badger chart really quick. Let's see. Badger, what's a Badger USD? That's not it. That's a fake Badger. Badger. Here we go. And you can see that, you know, Badger has been quite bullish since its launch. I mean, we're talking about a farm token that has somehow managed to launch, and it hasn't done much yet, right? But it's impressive that this isn't just dumped to hell. I mean, in a lot of these instances, you'll see these farm tokens like this just get absolutely decimated, which isn't something that that's happened yet. And as I've said before, I'm not more bullish on Rook or Badger. Actually, that's a lie. I'm probably more bullish on Rook. But I don't have any favorites. I love all my children. I've got a big Rook position just because it's important for me when I look at this. It's important for me to continue to understand. I've got one Hedgehog lot. I really want like multiple Hedgehog lots. I'm so bullish on Hedgehog, it hurts. And could I sell all of my Rook right now and get more Hedgehog? Fuck yeah, I could. But at the same time, I look at Rook and I'm like, damn, like the opportunity there, if Rook works, it literally, without a fucking doubt, hands down, is the biggest thing in DeFi, period. And it, you know, something like that, I've just got to kind of have strong hands on. It's when I look back at things like Ren, like Decred, and this is, you know, I departed from that. I got a little, you know, I wanted too much at the end of 2020. I departed from that mentality that served me so well for so long. When I've got that gut feeling about something, that gut feeling is what has given me everything. So I need to stick to those gut feelings and I need to be more mindful of them. I've got a gut feeling on Rook. I think Rook could be, I mean, a life-changing trade. Let's look at some Nansens, okay? I really can't be here forever. My throat's starting to hurt. My coffee's running out. Now I'm freezing cold, so let me zip my jacket back up. Okay. Let's look at some Nansens. We're gonna look at the Nansens for the shit I'm in, first and foremost. MTA, Nansen, add the filter. Of course, there's a problem displaying the chart. It always happens like that. I'm not quite sure what's up with that. Always have to refresh. Just kind of annoying. Cap is continuing to grow. Cap could be a major sleeper. I've got a lot of friends that are still in Cap. CAP, cap.finance. Alright. So, Sablier, I don't know how to pronounce it. It sounds French, so, you know, like I said, I get an Alabama pass sometimes, and, one of those Alabama passes are going to be for Naval, and another one is going to be for this. Is it Sablier? Is it Sablier? I don't know. It's a real-time emissions thing. Change over 7 days, 341,000, okay? Booby, change 308,000. Why do coins leave a centralized exchange? That's typically because people are accumulating them. You know, it's a bad sign if coins are going into a decentralized exchange. DeFi Maximalist dot ETH is a new name that is emerged here. I'm not quite sure who this is. 269,000 MTA in his public ENS. DeFi Maximalist.eth is also activist investor.eth. It's going to be difficult to actually see who's actually stacking MTAs here. If you look at the incentivized voting lockup, the balance now is 4,700,000 in 30 days. 700,000 more MTA have actually been locked up here in voting. Look at the other people accumulating. Whoever this is, the Landry, blah blah blah, out Ethereum has added 100,000 MTA to his stack. Why not here at $1? Makes sense. Just looking at MTA and you know what could be actually happening with MTA right now. You know, I've got this MTA perp pulled up. And this is what we're looking at. You know, we've got this diagonal here, which is really the barrier to our ascension. And once we can breach this diagonal, you know, which this structure is going to resolve at the end of our beginning of January, like January 10th, you know, we could potentially see some upside on MTA. Is that upside going to be limited? Probably until those emissions cap out, or until the emissions are changed or whatever. You have to keep in mind that while the emissions are stupid right now, the emissions effectively place the control of this market in the hands of the VCs. All the VCs come together and they say, hey, let's put MTA at 50 cents. Well, easy. All they have to do is they all agree that they're going to start selling their MTA until MTA is at 50 cents. All of these VCs say, hey, let's take a lot of the sell pressure off of MTA. Then they stop selling their coins. But the reality here is that you are 100% at the mercy of the VCs. And if they decide that the number is going to go up, it's going to go up. And if they decide that people need to experience more pain on MTA, then well, guess what? You're going to experience more pain on MTA. It just is what it is. But watching this right here, this diagonal in particular, a break on this diagonal, I mean, really, since this is the entire downtrend, right? A break on this diagonal right here would signify that the trend has actually shifted on MTA. And MTA has spent, since early November, MTA has been above where it is right now. And this definitely is kind of a break in the structure. You know, we saw some weird shit going on right here. I don't know, maybe somebody decided to close their short or whatever. But this definitely is looking good. Now, let's move on to Rook. I know a lot of people have been curious about the Nansen on Rook. Now, Rook is an interesting one to check the Nansen on because there's no staking mechanism or anything like that to where you're actually hiding people's intentions on Rook. Come on, come on. Okay. So the keeper and LP distributor, you know, this is the amount of Rook that's going to be distributed over the course of January. As you can see right now, we still have about 80,000 Rook that has yet to hit the market. Now, keep in mind that while there is 80,000 Rook that will hit the market, this Rook isn't just Rook printed out of thin air, unless you are an LP. And even then, as an LP, you have an opportunity cost to mining this Rook. And I do believe there are better opportunities out there. So maybe these people are just accumulating. And when I say better opportunities, I just mean in terms of the amount of ROI you're getting. But, you know, there is a significant amount of Rook that has yet to hit the market that is going to be hitting the market over the next month. But that market does have a kind of a floor price. Now, we do have a couple of notable entries here. This wallet right here, 100,000 Rook. Oops. Oh man. Okay, hold on. Okay, pull Rook back up. Sorry about that. I am gonna have to scroll out just a bit because I can't even fucking see anything. I can't even scroll to the right here. I thought I could do it with my fancy G502, but I'm hitting the over button and nothing's happening. So what else? Okay. Is there some like top secret way to scroll over to where you guys can still see this information? Yeah, we're gonna look at MPH. Yeah, I like SFI and RGT. RGT, I'm super bullish on. It actually has great token economics too. At the end of the day, as I was talking about earlier though, you know, I just came to like the self-realization that I can't be in everything. There's so many things out there. I just can't be in everything. I need to be a community member. I need to just be a bag holder and see what happens. You know, you look at something like RGT, and I'd love to have a big RGT bag, but the reality is that, you know, my thesis here is buy things that are DeFi primitives, base layers, right, for other people to build on. Buy things, of course, as always, that are reasonable market caps, that I think that there is upside there. Buy things with actual value accrual to the token itself. Like MPH, staking my MPH, I get paid protocol fees. That's sick. You know, if MPH gets huge and I'm staking it, I mean, every week I'm getting paid DAI. That's badass. Just like Hedgic. You know, I stake my fucking Hedgic. It's not much right now, but, you know, if that shit blows up, I mean, if I think about it this way, if I'm even able to make 2 or 3 Ethereum per week and that's sustainable, you know, that could be $3,000 per week. That could be 150 grand a year just in revenue generation. You know, do you even have to sell at that point? I actually like boring DAO. They liked a couple of my Twitter posts and it worked. They got me to look at them. And I think it's cool. I like it. Oh, dude, Ren is a mega gold mine for 2021. Ren is potentially one of the biggest projects in DeFi. If you look at all the things that Ren VM can do, it's just astounding. Now, I'm not in any oracles. I've never really been a big oracle guy. I'm gonna have to shrink this down because I need to see the Etherscan button. And hopefully, can you guys still see this? I want to make sure everybody can still see this. I don't want people to just take my word for it. I want you to actually see the screen. Oh my god. Ugh. Okay. Apologies for that. If you're a guy that needs to wear glasses, you better put them on. Hey, Rizo, welcome, man. Rizo. Okay. So, this right here is Polychain. Let's take a look at their wallet. Are they fucking with other shit in here? Nah, this is just a wallet specifically for Rook. Let's see if we can track them down at all. And these guys are just bouncing their shit around everywhere. From ether mine. I don't fucking know. Whatever. We know this wallet right here is Polychain. This wallet right here is Three Arrows. Etherscan. They got a couple things in here, and you know it's Three Arrows because look, they've got their Rook. They got some DDX. Woo Trade is in here too. Woo's kind of interesting. I need to do more research on Woo. I'm not really sure of the hype or the value accrual behind it, but it could be something that's big. But this is Three Arrows right here. Highly doubt that they plan on selling any of this. High balance. But look, right here, okay. Some elite dex trader. That guy must be. He must know what's going on. Heavy dex trader, this guy's added 259 to his Rook stack. Heavy dex trader, he's added 1,000 to his Rook stack. The important thing to note here is that if you look at the 7-day change and you really think about what's going on here, The only ones that are actually in the red are the distributors. Okay. Everybody else is stacking rooks or holding rooks. This guy added some more rooks, you know, 1,320. Now he's added 468. This guy's been stacking rooks. He's added 1,000 rooks in the last week. Holding rooks, stacking rooks, stacking rooks, stacking rooks. The thing here, though, is that you've got, look, token millionaire, token millionaire, token millionaire, heavy dex trader, elite dex trader. You got guys that presumably know a little, you know, might know a thing or two. And everybody is stacking rooks. You don't have people dumping rooks. You have people stacking rooks. You know, dapper.eth, heavy dex trader. This guy's offloaded a little bit. For the most part, people are stacking rook. And that's a good thing. That's a good sign. That's what we want to see, you know, is if I think that I'm smart money, is there other people that maybe see what I see? And that's a good sign. That's always a good thing. If I was to look at this and I saw that, hey, you know, these guys are stacking, these guys are selling, you know, this it's a big fucking mess, you know, it maybe is not as good of a sign. So Rook looks really, really solid from that perspective. Let's see if there's any other, like, notable information here. Yeah, there's really nothing else that's too notable here. Only thing to note, people are stacking rooks. Probably a good idea to be stacking those rooks. So let's check out MPH here. Now, MPH is a little bit more difficult to analyze, you know, because MPH does have staking. But, you know, if you have MPH, you know, it's not much right now because the protocol is in its infancy. But, you know, why not stake and get some fucking DAI, right? I mean, fucking DAI, you get paid in real stablecoin. You get paid in shit stables that are liquid. You know, MPH blows up and you're able to make, you know, a couple hundred DAI a week. That's sick. Okay. So here's your top balances, okay. Vesting, clone rewards, let's not really worry about that too much. This address, Token Millionaire, this is the actual development address. So they've obviously paid for some audit or something recently. Ugh. There is a bit of a change here. I've reached out to McFly and I've asked him exactly what this is. You know, technically it is their money, but I believe there's two audits that are going to be released in early January, and I'm speculating that they had to pay for the audits. They're not fucking around with BS companies. They've got good companies that are doing this. There's one audit that's already been released by DeFi yieldfarming.info or something like that. But look, Token Millionaire holding his rooks, layergroup.x or layerxgroup.eth. These guys have been holding their MPH for a long time, actually. If we actually look at the profiler here, and this is kind of an interesting thing to look at and something that we haven't looked at much. But you can see their, when did they first get it? You know, how has this evolved? So these guys have 9,190 MPH. You know, why they're not staking this is news to me, but we can go ahead and we'll pull up this chart because I want to see where did these guys buy this shit? So let's see here, Manson. So first received November 21st, 1349. Okay, so these guys acquired all of their Rook, or not their Rook, their MPH, much higher than it is right now. They are presumably the largest holders of MPH and they're really don't give a fuck. You know, the price is up, the price are down, the price is down. This is the kind of mentality I had when I was in things like Ren. You know, Ren went from 1,000 to 300 to 1,000 to fucking 280, you know, whatever. This shit was a roller coaster, but the people that held, the people that lasted, and, you know, Ren got adoption, those are the people that got rich as fuck, right? same kind of situation there. And it looks like even through the 22nd and the 23rd, this guy was increasing his balance. So all of this guy's buys were in here. So this guy is down quite a bit. Now, who is Layer X Group dot Ethereum? 2.4 million dollars of tokens. These are Aave guys. 88 MPH, Teller. They got some Spice. They got some Badger. They've got some good shit in here for sure. Stay poor, lols. Three ENSs. Let's see what their other ENSs are. Sorry, I've got really bad brain fog right now. I know you can see this ENS somewhere. Whatever. Doesn't really matter what their other ENSs are. Let's just go back. Did I click the right thing? Yeah, here we go. Anyway, pretty big whales. They're in some good shit. TRB, MPH, Aave, decent amount of Spice. Good project. I wish I could be in that as well. I'm not really sure about the value accrual to the Spice token, though. Maybe there's something I'm not aware of. You know, my main concern with Spice is just that Spice is an interesting idea that could be easily incorporated into other projects. They could use it. So I don't see Spice so much as a base layer. I see Spice more of like a proof of concept, which doesn't fit my new thesis. Let's see what else has gone in here. You know, high balance, medium dex trader. This guy stacked an extra 1,400. Lead dex trader holding. This guy is the problem right here. And you know, you're asking yourself, why is MPH going down? Well, it does appear that this guy is capitulating. He's got 2,165 of these left. Let's go ahead and check his profiler. And we can see when he actually started dumping. While that's loading, we'll just continue to look at this. First page is people holding and stacking. Second page is people holding and stacking. Third page is people holding and stacking. A couple guys that have sold, not many. For the most part, people are holding and stacking. Okay, so this guy started selling pretty fat stacks, like on the 26. Oops. So this was him. He started this whole cascade. This is literally just one dude tanking the price. So he sold his main stack, you know, which kind of started a lot of that cascade here. He didn't sell any on the 28th. Then on the 29th, it looks like his balance went down again. For the longest time, he was holding about this much, 2,100, and now he's back to where he was holding. Presumably, he could just say, you know, I'm good with around 1% of the supply, 1% of the circ, or 1% of the whatever, and, you know, I'll stick with that. 2,000 is still a good bit of MPH. Maybe he felt he was overexposed or whatever. Let's say this guy continues to say, I'm getting the fuck out of MPH. Well, there's only 2,000 more he could sell at this point. Now, Nansen is a tool for Ethereum. Zen. This is the first day where I've actually wanted Zens. It's really weird. Yesterday and the day before, I felt like shit and I didn't even want them. Because they hurt my throat. Okay. But it is really interesting though, like when you use Nansen and you can actually like see the direct events, you know, see who bought where, what's their acquisition price, who sold where. You know, when you look at a guy like Layer X Group and you say, this guy's got 9,000 MPH, and then you also think, well, damn, this dude's down like 80%. Like he's definitely not, he has no plans on selling. But where would this guy maybe consider selling? Well, if the price pumped. But you can be too worried about a guy like that that's bought there, has held all this way down and hasn't flinched. You got to wonder, you know, what are his intentions? What are his plans? Now, this is rewards. This is how much is actually staked. Now, staking and the accrual of protocol fees to your MPH is something that's relatively new. Let's check out the profiler for staking. Oh, I'm doing like 10,000 plus IU daily of vitamin D, lots of vitamin C. I've got a really good multivitamin too. I don't know if you guys are multivitamin guys. I take an orange triad. I've taken orange triad for like 3 or 4 years. It's my favorite multivitamin by a long shot. Orange triad, T-R-I-A-D. Maybe triad, maybe give me another Alabama pass on that. But you can see here that over time, the amount of tokens that are staked has been increasing. You know, more and more people are staking. Staking is good, you know, because staking removes floating supply off the market. You know, it's these coins that are staking are there to stake. Hey, fuck it. I'm holding this shit. I'm going to accumulate the protocol fees. But this is looking solid. You know, there's one guy that's dumped this market, and he's almost out of tokens. And he presumably might be done. You know, the big question here is, you know, has this guy's thesis changed? You know, what's he actually doing? So let's actually go look at this guy's wallet. It is interesting that this guy with that much worth is capitulating. Compound Ether, Wrap Bitcoin, big on ESD, empty set dollar. I do believe, let's just... Yeah, look at this. From this address. Okay, here's another address of his. Oh, that's straight from ESD. Okay, maybe you can mint it somehow. Let's look at this transaction. What the fuck actually happened here? Oh, withdraw. So he'd been like staking that MC set dollar or something. It wasn't like he was, he bought that MC set dollar. He's selling it VO, 1 inch there, Uniswap there, 1,000. He's dumping his empty set dollars. This dude is tax loss harvesting. 100%. Here's how, okay, let's check this out as well. Okay, this is why the token profiler is so important. Okay, so December 5th. This guy acquired around 5,500 more MPH. Yep. So he bought his MPH. Somewhere in here. And then he's selling right here. He's either tax loss harvesting or he just has some kind of stop loss or something like that. Not too worried about it. You know, the main thing to take away here is that you've got one guy, he's the sole dumper, and he's almost out of tokens and he's back to his original stack and maybe he holds that original stack and maybe he doesn't. Now this guy, it appears that he was one of the original, you know, he migrated his tokens over, so it'd be difficult to actually determine, you know, when he actually, did this when he bought these, but you know, who knows what he's doing. It is very strange to me that he would be bailing that hard, but he seems to be the only one that's doing that. So pretty cool to just investigate and kind of see, you know, where people bought, what their cost was, you know, when they sold. This is why I love Nansen, and if you can afford Nansen, I would highly recommend getting Nansen. Let's check something else out now. 1 inch, that might be an interesting one to look at. By the way, big congrats to all of you who got the 1 inch airdrop. I will take a little bit of credit for that. I rarely do that, but you know, I was very happy in some regard to be able to give back to all of you guys. You know, I hope everybody listening made a trade on 1 inch, got a piece of that pie on Christmas too. You know, no better day. I actually rugged myself on my 1 inch after talking about it all that time, which is, it's kind of funny. How did you rug yourself? Well, I'd had a couple glasses of wine. When I say a couple, more like four. And I got this big brain idea that if I put all of my 1 inch up for, and this is just thinking back on it, it's so funny. I had this big brain idea that if I put all of my liquidity up for 1 inch, very cheap, that people would have to buy it up and that all that Ethereum would go to me, just like a classic rug pull. But the reality is that I listed all my 1 inch for sale for like $1. So that was an epic cell phone, and one that will not be repeated, regardless of how much wine is consumed. But I'm very thankful that all of you hopefully maybe got a little bit of 1 inch token, and on Christmas that was a nice Christmas miracle there. Let's take a look at Hedgic. It's gonna make me refresh again, eh? Ugh. Okay. Now I'm burning up. Oof. Okay. Okay. So, with Hedgic, you have Ethereum staking, and you have WBTC staking. Oh, this is... Okay, hold on. I'm looking at the wrong thing. Okay. WBTC staking, Ethereum staking. These are just the lots. Over the past 7 days, it does... You know, if you look at the amount of Ethereum lots that are staked, this has actually decreased significantly. Whereas the WBTC lots are increasing. You know, it looks like people are saying... you know, there's more volume on WBTC. I'm going to stake mine on WBTC. What they don't understand is that they're competing with a lot more people for that bigger piece of the pie. Smaller piece of a bigger pie than Ethereum, rather than a bigger piece of a smaller pie here. Gradual token swap. I believe this is for our Hedgic, which, you know, if you're bullish on Hedgic, It might be a smart idea to accumulate these Hedgic IOU tokens, which I think you unlock 4% a week or something like that. Because eventually, you might end up have a... You will buy a Hedgic lot or a piece of that Hedgic pie for a lot cheaper than normal Hedgic costs. And those IOUs do convert to real Hedgic. Just something to be mindful of. This is going to be a difficult one to analyze, you know, just because so much of the holders, the hold... is in these staking contracts. Heavy Dex Trader, you know, really no change there. See, there's just not much to actually see here. Dex Trader, this guy's added, that guy's added. You can see here that for the most part, the guys that don't have enough Hedgic to have a lot that are maybe just speculating on upside, are holding their Hedgic or stacking Hedgic. And if you actually look at the price here, okay. What the fuck? You can see that Hedgic did bounce in a natural place to bounce. See, you know, we pulled all the way back to this zone. You know, people capitulated, sold their Hedgic down here, and we do appear to be bouncing. Now, the price of one Hedgic right now is around 12 cents. This is the Hedgic IOU token, and this is what I was talking about. If you're maybe a smaller wallet and you believe really hardcore in Hedgic and you think that Hedgic is your ticket to freedom, the Citadel, whatever you want to call it, and I've even considered doing this myself, you know, because I think, you know, like, hey bro, like maybe you could pick up a you know, whereas maybe, you know, let's say Rook goes to like $1,000 and I'm like, yo, I'm gonna take 1,000 Rooks and I'm gonna buy a bunch of Hedgic and you know, I'm going to spread out that exposure. Well, maybe I could buy five Hedgic lots, you know, with that right now. Or what if I could buy like 10 future Hedgic lots that I know I'm big bullish on Hedgic. I know Hedgic, you know, I'm going to be super bullish and people are going to build on Hedgic, you know, blah, blah, blah. I've already been over that. But if you look at this right now, and wow, this is actually people have, or they're arbing this, which is really interesting. But one Hedgic IOU is now worth 8 cents, which kind of sucks. But it used to be worth 5 cents. I wouldn't FOMO into this because right now you're accepting, I feel like it's a lot of risk to buy a Hedgic IOU at 8.5 cents because it's not as liquid and you can't immediately stake that and go ahead and start getting that value from the Hedgic platform. But you can see this big capitulation here. I mean, to be on the other side of that wick would have been very nice. But a strategy, you know, if you notice Hedgic IOU going down in price and you're really bullish on Hedgic, it might be a good idea to set some of those limits and scoop some of this super cheap because at some point you might end up getting a Hedgic lot for like half off, and that's fucking dank. Who is Mr. Robot 3? This is his first time here. Really enjoying the stream. Well, I'm glad you're enjoying it, man. Apologies, I'm not as energetic as I normally am. This stream isn't as fun as it normally is because I'm a little under the weather, but I miss you guys and I miss streaming, so I'm happy to be here. And to be honest, while I don't feel that great right now, this is making me feel a lot better. Just doing something that I love doing and doing something that's a little more normal for me. So thank you for being here. Much appreciated. Something to note on Hedgic, though. You know, once again, we've already been over why Hedgic is the shit and is going to get you a ticket to the Citadel. But looking at this, for the most part, the people that aren't staking are either hold gang or accumulating. Now, if you're not, let me go to Hedgic. Okay, Hedgic. Okay. So you can actually get these Hedgic IOU tokens, and this is actually a concept that you're going to see emerge a lot more in the future, is that, you know, when you're staking, and this is something that's coming with MTA as well, a big issue is that stakers are given non-vested tokens. Well, that's bad for your token economics, right? People that are staking shouldn't just be people there that are there to rape your protocol. They should be people there with a vested interest in your protocol. So rewarding these people that are providing liquidity on Ethereum and Hedgic options, or on Ethereum and Bitcoin Hedgic options, they should get this R Hedgic token. They should have a vested interest in the protocol, else they're just mooches, right? You're going to see that coming to MTA very soon, you know, which is I was talking about earlier, and a large improvement in the emission structure of MTA. Now that's what's coming to MTA. It's vested staking for that MTA. There's really no playlist. Oh shit, coughing makes my head hurt. Jesus Christ. Y'all, Bitcoin's fucking right now, by the way. Oof, Lord have mercy. Okay. It's important that people participating in these protocols that are providing liquidity, blah, 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 are vested. And that's a concept that you'll see emerge in I think a lot of protocols in 2021, that you're not gonna have just immediate crops you can farm and dump. Now, of course I can farm my R Hedgic, and if I'd like, you know, I can come in and I can sell it as a discount, but you know, as you see right here, you know, people have already marked this up a bit. Pretty cool, but check this out. Staking. So you have WBTC and Ethereum lots for Hedgic, and there's a total lot, 76 lots that are out there in the wild right now that are sharing platform fees that are generated from people that participate in Hedgic options, that trade Hedgic options. When you come to Ethereum, you can see that, you know, I've got one out of the 56 lots that are in deployment. And this is about a week's worth of staking rewards, and it isn't much now, but the idea here is that in the future, it's going to be a lot more, and that Hedgic lots are going to be worth a lot more. Now, Hedgic is on a bonding curve, which is really interesting, which basically means that there's all of this fucking Hedgic available for people to buy out there in the wild. But the bonding curve, as the price increases, is really going to put Hedgic price on the moon. And as these lots become more profitable, the price of the lots goes up substantially. So as I said earlier, you know, you don't make the money. And I actually saw a great post on Twitter that I can't remember who made the post I'm borrowing from. But you can't make great money in these DeFi protocols by buying into something that's already proven, that's already generating a lot of money for the holders. Because if you do that, you're the yield, you're the exit liquidity. This has already been proven, and the people that are selling a proven protocol. Hey, fuck it, I don't need profits on this. You know, hey, I've got five hedgeclots, and my five hedgeclots are worth $5 million. You know, why should I want to accumulate the profits when I can just, you know, I can rip the Band-Aid off. I can get my 5 milli and move on. Well, that's a case to where hedgic options is something that a ton of people have built on that's generating a lot of volume. It's doing a lot of good for the people that are staking hedgic, that are holding hedgic. And you can see hedgic right here. There's an analytics dashboard built out on Dune. Where you can pull out and you can see the staking lots over time, the daily rewards, the cumulative reward per staking lot. You know, if I had held Hedgic from when these staking lots went live, you know, which is kind of mid-October until now, if I had had one Bitcoin lot, I would have made a whole Bitcoin. Whereas if I had had an Ethereum lot, I would have been paid around $13,000. But still, just it's interesting to look at some of this stuff right here. And you see that, you know, with Ethereum, there's 153 active Ethereum options and 71 active WBTC options. Interesting, you can see all this stuff. Something cool to check out and something cool to watch. You know, I do think Hedgic is going to continue to be a really big deal. And one other important thing to note is the derivit. I don't know, is it derivit or a derivit or what? I think it's derivit, right? One important thing to note is derivit, who is the options king of crypto, right? They're doing tons of volume in options. Their KYC requirements go into a place, I think the last day is today. So in 2021, you gotta think, there's all this volume that's going to Deribit. And a lot of these guys might not be interested in KYCing. So if Hedgic was even able to capture, you know, 1% of that, 2%, 3%, there could be some serious upside for Hedgic. Because with these value accrual tokens, you know, things like Hedgic, things like MPH, you know, as we get more value locked, more users, etc., into the protocol, even Rook, you know, as more shit happens on Ethereum, Rook gets more valuable. There's more MEV to extract. You know, with Hedgic, as more people trade these Hedgic options, there's more value to extract here. With MPH, you know, the more people that buy these, that participate in fixed interest rate opportunities, the more people, or the more I get paid by staking my MPH, the more people that build on top of MPH. You can build options on top of MPH. You can build all sorts of different shit on top of MPH. The more people that do that, the more I get, the more value accrual goes to the token, the more money I make, the more I get paid. Super interesting. You know, one of the really cool things about MPH is it actually allows you to long interest rate, or not interest rate. Yeah, it allows you to long interest rates on lending protocols, which is pretty cool. So I can come into MPH and, you know, I can buy bonds and I can fill that gap. I can pay that guy that's agreed, you know, I'm cool with my 9% fixed interest on MPH. Let me just go ahead and pull up MPH here. God damn it. Okay. So you look, here's all these, I'll zoom in a bit. So I've got all these fixed APY opportunities and I can come in and I can say, you know, with DAI, I can come in, I can earn a 2.68% fixed APY. That's guaranteed to me. I'm going to get paid this. And then I'm going to get supplemented as well with MPH APY for a total APY, temporary APY of 24% on my DAI. So if I click add on this, lending pool, DAI, how much do I want to deposit? You know, what's my lending duration, et cetera, et cetera. Let's say, and it says the max is 100,000 DAI per deposit. So I come in, I want to deposit 100,000 DAI. I want to do it for 365 days. That's 2,687% fixed interest on my DAI deposit. MPH rewards, which are vested over a period of 7 days, are 882.6 MPH. You know, that's great, right? But when I withdraw my DAI that I have actually deposited, I'm going to need to pay back 264 of that. I think it's 1/3 or something like that of the initial withdrawal. So now you can see the temporary APY is higher, just because, you know, I am responsible for paying some of that back. Now let's imagine that I come onto to this shit and I want immediate capital right now. I deposit 100,000 DAI. I know that I'm going to get $2,000 in return for that over the year, guaranteed. You know, people are going to come buy bonds. When they buy those bonds, they're going to pay this $2,000 in exchange for my future yield. Okay. Oh God. But the interesting thing to note here is that, you know, fixed rate opportunities are huge in TradFi, traditional finance. I have no reason to believe that they're not going to be huge in DeFi as well. All sorts of shit can be built on this, and all sorts of shit is being built on this. So we'll just see what happens. But the interesting thing to note here is that if I am going to withdraw this, depositors need to repay 30% of their MPH tokens to when they want to withdraw. Relax, you can keep them warm by staking them, okay? Or I can just come in, I can sell this shit right now, for I can get $8,000 and I can do what I want with that $8,000. Now imagine people come in, and the risk here is that I deposit 100,000 DA onto the platform. I get this, I sell it, and holy fucking shit, I've got to pay back 1/3 of this DAI now. And guess what, DA, you know, MPA, or 1/3 of this MPH, and guess what, MPH is worth over $100 now, or MPH is $500. That puts a constant demand on actual MPH, because these people are going to constantly have to repay some of this MPH when they withdraw. So check this out. Deposit plain stablecoins or tokens, which will put into a DeFi yield protocol such as Compound, Aave, and YEARN. After depositing in the pool, you receive an ERC-721. That's an NFT that represents your deposit. You may transfer it to another account or even sell it on NFT markets such as OpenSea. Now, one of the cool things that they're going to be doing is actually wrapping those NFTs in an ERC-20. Which means that I can sell off my fixed rate opportunity, my fixed rate DAI. And here's where a lot of that building comes into play. I've got $100,000 deposited. I've got an NFT that represents that. And now I'm gonna wrap that NFT in ERC-20, which allows me to fractionalize it. And now I can trade and I can lend, I can do whatever with my fixed rate deposit. And that's useful in a lot of DeFi protocols. So I earn MPH tokens, are continuously vested for you for 7 days. When staking your MPH, you can claim your share of rewards from the 88 MPH reward pool where the protocol fees and yield farming rewards are collected. When your lending period is over, you withdraw your principal together with the fixed rate interest earned. When you withdraw, you need to return 30% of the MPH tokens received at the time of deposit. I do think that you can withdraw early. Let's see here. Yeah, I do think that you can withdraw early, but the consequence to you would be that I would have to repay 100% of the MPH that was given to me when I did this. Super cool though, but if you come back and look at this, you know, there's all of these fixed rate opportunities. Like right now on SUSD, you know, I can come in, I can deposit 100,000 SUSD. I can earn a fixed rate interest on that SUSD. Oh shit, that's a million. Yeah. 9,000 in the bank guaranteed. Get a little extra MPH on the side, right? Which is huge. And let's say in the future that the yield, the variable rate falls below what I've committed to. For this, I'm locked in at this fixed rate. The guys that bought bonds have bought my future interest. So I get to lock in this fixed interest rate. And that's a huge opportunity for me. There's so many different things that can be built on top of this, and so many opportunities, like I said, that can be made. But you can see there's all sorts of different pools here. And I do know that McFly and Spotaboom of Badger are talking right now, which makes me really excited for some kind of opportunity to where Badger has an incentivized pool on an incentivized fixed rate pool for Bitcoin on MPH. Imagine being able to lock in a rate on your Bitcoin for the next year. We don't know what Bitcoin is going to be a year from now. We don't know the state of DeFi. We don't know what's going on, et cetera, et cetera. So by being able to lock in these fixed rate opportunities, it's a financially kind of responsible thing to do. You know, the crops aren't always going to be plentiful out there. It's not always going to be like, oh my God, you know, you can get 60% interest, you know, doing this or that. Super cool staking dashboard right here. You can see claimable real DAI rewards. You can see you're actually paid and protocol fees accumulated. Okay, so 88 MPH charges at 10% on fixed rate interest offered to depositors. So as TVL grows here, you get paid more, right? It's directly correlated your earnings to the amount deposited. The fee is charged upon deposit maturation. The accumulation is not continuous, but you'll get this. But you do get protocol fees as these deposits are made and as MPH routes your liquidity for you. And these protocol fees are accumulated. And then those are what's used to pay the next week daily reward for MPH. Still very cool to see actual accrual value going on here. Hedgic, very cool too. Okay. So we looked at Hedgic, Rook, MPH, you know, blah, blah, blah. Let's check out a couple different things. Maybe we'll start with 1-inch here. Just as an interesting thing to look at. I mean, if we're talking actual value plus value accrual, Hedgic is already like stage two of that, right? Hedgic already has big TVL. Hedgic already has big players in. MPH is an opportunity to get in on the ground floor on something that could be fucking enormous for good value. You know, if you look at 88 MPH, if you also look at the stats, you can see historical interest distributed, the price of MPH, the total supply, but also what's actually in circulation right now. And you can see that you're buying at a $4.6 million valuation, which is pretty cool. Okay. So we got Nansen on 1-inch. And this actually, this might be a little difficult. We'll see. Distribution on 1-inch is quite good. What are these? Oh, top balances. Okay. You know what? We're not going to be able to look at this because all of this happened within the last 7 days. There's not going to be any discernible information here. This will be a better one to take a look at 1 week after the airdrop happened. And Jarkotov, whatever. Appreciate you being here, man. So let's do a couple of these things that you guys wanted to see. Let's take a look at RGT, RARI governance token. A couple of you guys, you know, have been asking about RGT. Man, any day now, right? Okay. And if you look at it, for the most part, people have been stacking RGT. 7 day change, 300,000. This guy has sold about half of his. All of these guys are holding their RGT. Holding or stacking. Now the token economics in RGT are quite good. A lot of people overreacted to the governance proposal. A lot of people overreacted to the governance proposal in RGT to increase the supply, to continue to incentivize people to come in and use the platform. And I think that's what caused a lot of that sell-off. That sell-off was absolutely brutal, brutal enough to shake me out. I probably wouldn't have been shaken out if it had stopped at around 50 cents, but you know, when it got down to 30, I was just like, holy fucking shit, like this is... This is really ugly. RGT though, from a Nansen perspective, does look quite good. You know, for the most part, people are stacking this shit and they're holding it. And RGT is as quite low in the market cap front. Let's see. Bitcoin Gecko, RGT. Yeah, check this out. The FTV of this shit is only $3 million, and it's a fantastic yield aggregator. I know these guys are super smart and they're building a good product. Yeah, we'll check out PRQ if it's there. And it does appear to be there. Give it just a second to load here. It's always a little slow. Come on, okay. So you can see too, under balance changes in the last 7 days, you can see a lot of people that actually aren't showing up here under top balances anymore. When we're actually looking at this though, I mean, these are the people that are holding, that are believing, you know, whatever. I'm not quite sure what all these wallets are. You know, I'd like to believe that these are probably like some kind of vesting wallets or something like that. For the most part, though, it does appear that people are either accumulating this or holding it. You know, when we look at these balance changes over the last 7 days, there are some. You know, if you look at this first page, you can see a lot of these balances have increased by significant amounts. That's Bilexy, whatever. And you do see, some people that have capitulated. For the most part, though, it appears that people are holding this. I don't see too much indication that people are buying too much more or adding more to their stacks. There are instances of that occurring. But when you look at those high balances, you know, the guys that could really tank the price, you know, they could really shake things up. It doesn't appear that those guys are offloading their supplies. This guy, what the fuck's up with this guy? Let's see what's up with him. Yeah, not 100% sure what's going on with this guy. Out. This must be some kind of distributor or something of the like. We're sending it all to one address. Let's see where it's going. Aha. Yeah, it does look like this is some dude and he's dumping his PRQ. You can see, you know, 16 hours ago, he's methodically boom, 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 boom. I mean, look at this. Boom, 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 dump, 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 dump. And you see, you know, there's instances like this where you see, I mean, like MPH, where you've got that one dude with a big stack who, or a big stack relative to the amount of liquidity, and he's just boom, boom, boom. He's just hammering. He's selling. You see that here. This is a guy who's selling relentlessly, who has been selling over the past 30 days relentlessly, and who foreseeably will continue to sell relentlessly. He's still got 2.7 million tokens to unload. So even though maybe we've got some people that are adding a little bit more, some people that are really believing in this, you do have like this dark cloud here, and that this dude is just selling all of his fucking shit. And there's really no indication here that he will stop selling. Let's go ahead and look at his profile. Yeah, look at this shit. He started on December 18th. And has just been hammering this market ever since. Now, let's go take a look at the chart. So he started selling Here. And he has been selling this entire breakout, this entire run. Interesting. Yeah, so we checked out BRQ. We'll look at a coconut. You guys just understand that not everything is on Nansen. Looks like a coconut is. So we'll have a look at that for you. I mean, and we're seeing a lot of, well, who? That's not necessarily a bad sign. Medium Dex Trader, this guy's been offloading a lot. That guy's been offloading a lot. This guy's been offloading a lot. Offload. Offloading. I mean, we're seeing a lot of, oh, a coconut.eth. Of course, this one is stacking, right? And also this guy. I don't know why there's two separate mentions of him here. That's kind of weird. Yeah, we'll do boring DAO. I mean, let's check out the chart. It looks like we had spoken about this on a previous stream, and typically, you know, when something like this is up, that means that, yo, holy shit, this is up 10x. Like, why would you buy that? I am seeing signs that people are just selling up here, that they're taking profit. You know, I wouldn't imagine that you're fucked in any regard, you know, by being in this, but you do have to remember that, you know, the downside on this is potentially enormous. You know, let's say that our support level would be, you know, right here ish, right? And we've got another 15% to go to that support, you know, and maybe it bounces, maybe it doesn't. But what's the next level? You know, maybe something down here. And that would represent another about 50% downside. I'm very, especially, and I don't look, I want to just start with the disclaimer that I don't know anything about a coconut. It might be the next Bitcoin. It might be the next YFI for all I know. And this could be just a total idiotic assertion, you know, just because I know so little about it. I do know that looking at what's happening on Nansen, when you see larger wallets that are selling here and have been selling, and I look at something that went 10x very rapidly and is now deciding it's doing that. A lot of times that is, you know, that's a trap. It's not distribution, or it's not accumulation. It's not a bull flag. It's distribution. And you can actually see that distribution right here. You know, where you do see people that are taking profits. And then two, you know, the biggest balance changes over the last 7 days, and you're looking at, you know, a lead dex trader who's sold 24,000, and this rando who's sold 32,000, and, you know, even these guys, you know, I sold 4,000. Yeah, we spoke about Hxro earlier. And look, I'm really not trying to, like, I talked about, you know, my new thesis, and I talked about value accrual, token economics, DeFi primitives, you know, base layers for, like I said, MPH is amazing because literally there's 100 different dApps that could be built on top of MPH using MPH as that base layer. that haven't been conceived yet, that haven't been built yet. And I do know that the MPH team is capable of doing that. They, if you go look at what these guys have done, they have several like real world apps that have a shitload of users, and they've got a fucking, these guys released like a keto app that has a ton of users and a subscription model. It's a beautiful app. But these are guys that have done real code. These aren't fuckboys that are messing around like with Solidity, you know, trying to get rich quick. They're building something real and something big. Yeah, I'll check out maybe two or three more coins on Nansen. Now I'm fucking freezing again. I am gonna leave in a second. I need to chill. This has been good, and it's been nice to do something normal after sleeping the last 2 days, but I'm not bulletproof. All right. Deus is, it would be difficult to look at on Nansen, just because a lot of it is bonded and staking and, you know, this and that. Things like that are a little more difficult to check out. Especially like with MPH, I can kind of look at it because I've got a deep understanding of what MPH is, and, you know, I can look at that staking contract and, you know, I know what it means to stake, and I know, you know, look at the holders, and, you know, I can actually discern information about it because I have knowledge. But, you know, I'm not extremely well versed on Deus, so, you know, I could look at Deus, and but it wouldn't necessarily be interpretable. Maybe it would. Look, I'm not really big on like Litecoin and shit like that, and I don't think I'll ever go over Litecoin on the stream. Somebody asked for something. Pylon. Look, guys, I think Pylon is poo. People have been trying to hype Pylon to me for literally like 3 months. Chart kind of looks like something I'd buy. I mean, let's see if people are accumulating this shit. OBV isn't too hot. Should just stray down. All right, let's check out this Nansen though. I mean, guys, Pylon is like the DeFi version of cloud farming or cloud mining contracts, and I've been around the block. Like, cloud mining contracts never work out. It's a scam. If it was so great, then why are they allowing you to buy it? Not a lot of selling here. Let's see if there's any notable, like, larger balance changes. Yeah, a couple people have bought, you know, 2011 here. How much does this shit cost? About $100 per pylon. I mean, based on the chart alone, this may be an interesting thing to play. You know, we've got this large kind of descending wedge. Make that a little prettier, yeah. You know, if we see a breakout here, but the number one thing is a breakout with volume. There's no volume here, there's no interest. There's no hype. Who's gonna tweet that Pylon's broken out, you know, to even let people know? I like the chart. Not so big on, you know, the Nansen. It does look like people aren't really dumping, which is good. P-Vault V2, you know, maybe these are people that are staking, I would assume. They're staking in this vault. So it's difficult to really discern any information. you know, you can see that there has been a change. Let's go ahead and look at the profiler for the Pylon vault just to see, you know, the ebb and flow. You know, are we trending? Are we having more people stake this, or are people getting tired of it? When not poor, hopefully soon, my friend. Yeah. What you can see here is that not many more people are staking. There is a diminished interest in that. It looks like most of the stakers came on board in late November, and they've been staking ever since. So if you look at from the end of November now until now, this is when people started staking-ish in this area. And this is where we are now. So down 50% from that. And there hasn't really been people saying, oh my God, Pylon's super cheap. You know, I gotta come in and I've gotta have a piece of this. I don't know, had a couple of people ask about Strong. I think Strong is doo-doo. Doesn't matter whose name is on something. I know a lot of people got butt fucked by this. So, you know, big apologies to you, you know, if you did. I need to do a new study because, you know, I know they've done a lot of revamping of the token economics and this and that. You know, but at the end of the day, I'm not particularly bullish on Strong. We could take a look at Nansen. You know, I do know, I think Strong has staking mechanics, you know, which, like I said, we could look at it on Nansen, but it would be difficult to really discern much there, similar to Pylon. And Strong is actually not even on Nansen. So there's that for you. Somebody asked about Un. I don't know what that is. I'm going to go ahead and pull up the chart while Nansen's loading. That's Union Protocol. Interesting. Okay. No, this is just on the daily time frame. Put it in the 12-hour. It's not as hot on the 12-hour. It does look like interest, you know, volume is kind of diminishing here. You know, we are at look at over the last 12 hours. It appears that people, you know, were saying, hey, you know, we're coming down at the lows. Like, this is support, right? Let's buy it. And then you've got this bearish engulfing on the 12-hour, which is just super ugly. And is there even 7 days of history? Yeah, there's 7 days of history on this. Hold on. Okay. All right. Okay. High balance. I assume this was some kind of ICO or something, you know, so you've got these people that came in and probably bought the ICO, and it does look like that they're holding for now. Change over 7 days. How long is, I mean, what are we talking about here? Yeah. So Nansen should be able to look at this. A couple of people have scooped up a sizable chunk of this. You know, a lot of people seem to be holding and accumulating this. Doesn't appear, if this were an ICO, it doesn't appear that a lot of people are actually selling. You know, maybe some of the people that are selling have already capitulated and, you know, gotten out. But, you know, we're seeing pages on pages of kind of flip-flopping. Like, look, this guy has sold, you know, 1.2 million, but this dude right here has bought 1.3. So I said, I'm not really sure, you know, what this actually is. So it's difficult for me to do any kind of fundamental analysis or anything like that. Oh, lost trust in the team after that? Yeah. But I would really be watching this. You know, with these things, they can go into price discovery. Maybe there was a pre-sale, and maybe right now people are in profit. So, and they're looking at it like, yo, you know, like this is on support, so I'm not selling. And very well, you know, this could be the bottom. But you also have to consider, you know, from a psychological standpoint, one of those guys dumps that has that fat sack of token, and now we're right here instead of right here. And you have to consider that literally the future of this chart could be in one person's hands. You know, this guy decides that he wants to dump it down to here. And then you've just got all of this explored downside, and you've got to wonder too, you know, how much in profit is this? You know, I see a lot of people too, you know, oh, it's got backing from Alameda, you know, this and that. You need to understand, if you, almost every fucking up and coming DeFi protocol is backed by Alameda. So, you know, while in the past, I think that backed by Alameda could have been a big thing, but you also have to remember that Sam's got $1 billion and it doesn't matter to him if these DeFi protocols succeed or don't. He's just investing in everything because he can. You know, when I said earlier that, you know, I got too spread out, you know, I really should have focused on making these concentrated bets and being a community member, being a bag holder and riding it out and seeing what happens. You know, that's only because I don't have $1 billion. I can't afford to be exposed to everything. Sam can be, you know, can't afford to be exposed to everything. So, you know, I wouldn't consider an Alameda backing is good in the sense that every resource that, you know, should be at your disposal is probably there. You know, you got a guy that can inject TVL. You got a guy that can, you know, get you in touch with the right people, all of that. But at the same time, you know, you got a guy, he's invested in fucking everything. It doesn't necessarily mean that, oh my God, Alameda's in, pile in. SBF, talking Alameda. I don't even know who Bering Waters is. That means nothing to me, and I might just be ignorant. But if it means nothing to me, it probably means nothing to everybody else. Just interesting to watch, though. Not a fan of that 12-hour. If you look at the daily, just how that's shaping up, it's not really an attractive daily. I mean, that just looks like a straight-up rejection to me. I would look at the ICO price of this, you know, whatever the public sale price was. I would assume that people are in profit from that. And I would assume that if we were to break down here somehow, that those same people would start getting scared and we would see some of the supply move to the market. It's on a Periscope. If you have Twitter on Periscope, you can, or if you have Twitter on your phone, if you just go to Twitter and you go to my profile, at Cryptomessiah, it should be the last post on there. You can just click and move right over. But I will say we're not gonna be streaming for too much longer. Just because, you know, I'm getting a little exhausted here. It's having difficulty putting together my coherent thoughts again. Yeah, Bering Waters, they might be in SNX, Aave, Wi-Fi, others. You know, like I said, maybe this is the next Wi-Fi. I just need to do more research. It's cool to see somebody like that in on this, you know, but at the end of the day, these guys got in for way cheaper than you, and you've got to consider how much room is there. And also consider, you know, let's say a perp swap appears for this on FTX, then it's time to run. Because that just means they can just sell it. Yeah, let's check out Boar. Boar's going to be the last thing we look at. Boring DAO. Healthy uptrend here. We're seeing, you know, a lot of people are like, what is an uptrend? You know, how do I know what an uptrend is? It's actually easier than you think. And there's a lot of different methods to actually recognize you're in an uptrend. But this is a clear uptrend. What that means is that we have higher highs and higher lows. Higher high, higher low. Higher high, higher low. When something's in an uptrend, you have to assume that it will continue to be in an uptrend. You don't know necessarily when it's going to reverse. So let's say Boring DAO comes up here and then comes down here, you know? Then you have to start thinking, is this in a downtrend now? You know, has this trend reversed? Because now we made a lower high and a lower low. And is that the new trend? That now we're gonna bounce from here and now we're gonna make an even lower low. You know, we're gonna come down to here. What we're actually, you know, looking for to happen is for this to continue doing what it has done since late October. I mean, the performance here isn't exceptional, but what's one thing to note is that this shit has been uptrending throughout the month of November, which is a month where a lot of shit was downtrending. So if we come up and we make yet another higher high, And then make yet another higher low, you can know that, hey, I'm gonna continue holding my boring DAO. And let's check out Nansen. Surely this is here. Yep. I do like the FA on boring DAO. I've already checked it out. We'll go over boring DAO in detail, maybe at a later date. Let's check this out, though. Like I said, this is going to be the last thing that we check out. Sitting here at number 375. FTV is a little high. Not sure what's going on with that inflation. I did look at it at some point, but it's been a minute. I looked at it, I think, 2 or 3 weeks ago. So decentralized asset bridge, accessing different blockchains. Users a safe way to maximize their utilization rate of crypto assets. So for each blockchain asset, there's an exclusive minting tunnel operating in the form of a DAO and performing a bidirectional mapping between blockchain assets and ERC-20 tokens. So boring DAO is similar to Keeper. Period. Keep. K-E-E-P. And it's similar to Ren. Everybody's doing it in their own unique way. But just so you know what it is, that's what it is. I've got Bitcoin. I want my Bitcoin on Ethereum. I'm going to use a Boar tunnel, and now my Bitcoin is on Ethereum. ...70% minting fees allocated to tunnel operators. That's that concept of value accrual back to the token itself. It's not another worthless governance token, okay? Incentives. There's a boring farm. 30% of boar is going to be distributed through this farming, mint mining, rapier. Okay, that's cool. So if you're using them, they're going to be giving you boar as well. I've got Bitcoin. I want to have my Boar Bitcoin or O Bitcoin or whatever they're calling it. And they're going to pay me Boar for being in that asset, which is pretty cool. So there's some kind of tunnel here, which has increased a bit. A token millionaire, certainly that's a team member or somebody that's vested. For the most part, and this is pretty evident in the chart, you've got a lot of people that are just holding their board. It's quite expensive, $200. So you see these smaller token amounts, you know, are actually more significant than you think. Yeah, for the most part, people are holding. Let's see these balance changes. This guy, token millionaire, who is this? Yeah, this is like some kind of distributor contract or something, so nothing to worry about there. Medium Dex trader had 130 something boar. He's big on Woo Trade now. And he sent Tether to all sorts of different addresses. He sold his boar on Sushi Swap 4 days ago. This guy, 103 boar. Out to some kind of contract. And he sent it to this. Which maybe this is, he's staking it or something like that. Moringeo looks really solid. Hard to argue with the chart. It's not like it's up an absurd amount. It's been making higher highs and higher lows. It's technically, you know, what's on support right now. Could it fall lower? Yeah, for sure. Who knows though? Like I said, it's just not up that much. You know, it was up even 350. You know, like let's call this a low right here. Let's measure that. So even from that low to high, I mean, you're only up 3x, right? So this really hasn't, you know, it's not like, oh my God, this went 20x and like people are for sure going to be selling, you know, moving forward because it did it really rapidly. It's a healthy uptrend on a good product and foreseeably with good token economics. Something to check out. I'm not in it, need to do more research, but when I'm talking about value accrual to the token, you know, when I'm talking about my new thesis, why I'm in Hedgic, why I'm in MPH, this fits the bill. You know, the main thing here is getting users. And there is competition here. With MPH, there are other people that are doing what MPH is doing, but they're not out yet. Like Swivel, I think is one. Let's see if we can find Swivel here. The decentralized protocol for fixed rate lending and interest rate derivatives. This is swarmed with VCs, Multicoin, CMS, Electric, Divergence, Defiance. Swivel is upcoming competition for MPH, but you once again are in a situation where it's probably gonna have absolutely garbage token economics. You got VCs that got it for 10 times cheaper than you, etc., etc. And we've seen kind of a paradigm shift to where that sort of thing is kind of ugly for protocols. I mean, just look at MTA, right? Bor has competition. Ren, you know, you've got other like custodial services like WBTC, for example, you know, any kind of wrapped asset like that. You've got Keep, TBTC, T assets. There's a lot of competition there, so just remember that. With MPH, there's zero competition. With Hedgic, there's some competition. But if you look at Hedgic versus all of the competition, it's shitting on them. If you look at Octus, Octus has 80,000 TVL, $80,000. Hedgic has like 80 million TVL. It's a big difference there. TVL speaks volumes. There's an upcoming one too called Siren. Which could be really interesting, Siren decentralized options. Nobody's talking about it. Do it. Here you go. Here. Not available in my location. They've walled out U.S. participants and shit. Go check out their Medium, though. I really like these guys. I think this could be something. They've got a liquidity provider program right now. I'm going to go ahead and post this in the chat. I think you can go supply liquidity and get some of the and farm some of these Siren tokens. Yeah, OPYN, too. Saying Sync. It's funny, as Sync was one of the original tokens that I actually made money on back in like 2014. I know it's totally different now. Maybe this is Sync token. Yeah, Sync bonds. Sync. Check out their chart. What the fuck? That's not something you could ever convince me to buy. No thoughts on open doing airdrop. Look, my main thing is like, DYDX, like there's all sorts of different shit you can buy right now that or not buy, that you could use that'll potentially do an airdrop. I think really high probability is something like DYDX. DYDX is fucking sick. Look at this order book. Like, have you ever seen a decentralized exchange order book move like that? Clean chart. Nice order book. Let's connect my wallet. Okay. You can say, you know, I've got a little bit of ETH left in my margin account because I have made trades here. I know I've made trades on here. I'm trying to look for my history. Where's my trade history? There's got to be an area here. Maybe it's under more? No. Oh. And I'm on margin. Well, I know for a fact I made trades on here and my trade history is not showing. So I'm not quite sure what's going on there, but what I would do, I would not only make a couple of trades here, but I would also put a little bit of capital, you know, maybe a few Ethereum into your margin account. If you go ahead and deposit in there, you just hit this deposit button and it'll show you how to deposit and you can earn a small interest rate on that. But I would imagine that they'll be doing some kind of snapshot on who's actually lending on their platform. As well as maybe a snapshot of, you know, who's made trades. So that's just mind-blowing to me. You can't trade perps in the US, but they do have perpetual contracts. You can do margin trading on the US though, and that gives you 5x leverage. And just tell you from like my personal experience using this platform, it's a joy to use. No, I use USDC. I mean, look, you can see that I've got I've got dust balance in here. It's an awesome platform though. Just check this out. Look, I could put in, you know, 100 Ethereum long at 5x leverage. And the slippage is minimal. 0.02% price impact. And if you're looking, if you're an Ethereum trader, if you're a Bitcoin trader, and you're looking for an alternative to a centralized exchange, this is amazing. Yeah, that's honestly, I'm a little perplexed right now. You know, I would imagine that would be there. Oh, here we go. So you can see, you know, that I've done my due diligence. I knew that I had fucking history here, okay? So you can see, you know, I've just made some trades. I've generated some volume on this platform. Hey, if there is an airdrop here, then I'll get it. But I would suggest you make some trades here. You know, put a little bit in the lending wallet. See what happens. Cover your bases, just like 1inch. You know, I made my life 1inch for literally months. Everything I did was 1inch. I used the Chi Gas token. I mean, and 1inch, to be honest, even though the airdrop's over, I'm still using 1inch. It's fucking awesome. 1inch is the shit. But use the Chi Gas token. Do this, do that. make some trades here though, and you know what, you don't even have to get massive profits. You know, if you fucking open and close a couple of positions for 0.1% loss or 0.1% profit and generate that volume, I bet you'll be sitting pretty when it comes time for them to do an airdrop potentially. DYDX, let me here. I mean, guys, free coins, right? If it happens, free coins. You know, that's, it's free, free coins. Ugh. But that's it. Thanks for being here. I hope you learned something. Be safe. The money's gonna rotate. We're gonna get an alt season of sorts. The money always rotates. The real question is when? When does the money rotate? Think about this. Think about guys that are in massive profit for Bitcoin right now, but don't want to pay taxes on that next year in just 4 months. Well, think about that. When would these guys be taking profit? Well, tomorrow, right? I think that money could rotate massively to altcoins in January because of this, because you have a lot of altcoins at attractive levels right now. You know, we're sellers have run out, you know, we're the charts wrecked, and the product's been built out. I've never seen building faster than I have in the DeFi space. But a lot of these guys will that plan on rotating are not planning on rotating until 2021 for tax reasons. And you're seeing a lot of downside on DeFi altcoins in particular because of tax loss harvesting at the end of the year. And then coupled with, you've got guys that are tax loss harvesting, that's causing a lot of sell pressure on these DeFi markets. And then you've got money that wants to come in and that wants to, you know, buy some of these protocols and things, these things that could be potentially undervalued, that don't want to pay the fucking taxes this year. All they got to do is just wait to sell their Bitcoin or whatever till January and rotate until January. And then they can literally, they buy an entire, you know, 1 year and 4 months for them to pay taxes on whatever profits they've made there. Very, very bullish in January. I think we're going to see not mega moon alt season in January, but I think we're going to see the tide start to turn and, you know, we'll see some of these DeFi charts start to look really good, start to look really attractive. In terms of regulations, I've been here a long time. I've seen it all when it comes to regulations. China's banned Bitcoin how many times? Anytime I hear about regulation, unless it's, yo, the SEC is fucking XRP up the ass. Anytime I hear about regulation, I don't factor it in. If all of a sudden tomorrow I hear that, yo, the SEC's got a massive pending lawsuit against Hedgic, then you know what, you probably want to sell. But think about this. The SEC's got a massive backlog of dog shit for them to go through from 2017 that they are going through right now. If you look at something like Ripple, Ripple's been out since forever. Ripple's been going on for 7 years. And now Ripple's on the menu here in 2020, at the end of 2020. That just goes to show how far these guys are backlogged. So any kind of regulation that would really fuck, or any ruling, any dog shit that would really fuck up your DeFi shit, in my opinion, is a couple of years out. You know, they still got a lot of turds they need to clean up and bag up from 2017. And I think you're gonna continue to see more of these, you know, I mean, ADA gets sued, this guy gets sued, this guy. If I had a big ADA bag, I'd be terrified right now. Or Tezos. Or things like that. You know, those are targets. There's a little buffer right here though, and I think that in this buffer window, there's opportunity. So I'm just going to any kind of regulation, unless it's directly related to my holdings. Any kind of regulation that happens, I'm gonna look the other way. Doesn't affect me, whatever. I mean, if you really think about it, ADA, it could be an extremely prime target. I would not be surprised to see that ADA is getting sued by the SEC. And for ADA to be, you know, on the menu for the next course or two. You're going to see more of these lawsuits. More XRP gets fucked. More this gets fucked. Those dinosaur bags, doesn't matter how great they are. You know, you're in the crosshairs. You came through and you raised $100 million in 2017. Guess what, bitch? We're coming for you. We're coming for you. Yeah, that wallet tracing stuff, I doubt that's going to happen anytime soon. There's a lot of pushback in the industry. And I think the Biden administration is going to be friendly to Bitcoin and crypto. So, you know, we'll see what happens there. Whew. But I'm going to go lay down, watch some Stargate. Watching Stargate SG-1 on Netflix right now. Great show. I mean, maybe Chainlink. We don't know who's next. The way I see it, though, is Hedgic next? Fuck no. Is MPH next? Fuck no. Is MTA next? Fuck no. They may have their day. Not right now. And if they do have their day, that means that we're already rich and we don't care. I mean, yeah, Sam's second biggest Biden donor. That's no coincidence. I would imagine that, especially considering Democrats have traditionally been very friendly to technology corporations and innovation, pushing the envelope. I would imagine that having a Democratic presidency right now, you know, in terms of your altcoins, your bags, you know, shit going on, it couldn't have come at a better time. You know, Trump is not the Bitcoin and shitcoin prez. Biden is. So even if you hate Joe Biden and you think Trump is the best thing that's ever happened, and, you know, we're all entitled to our opinions. If you believe that, then I'm sure you have reasons for believing that, and more power to you. You know, I'm glad you think that. But undeniably, Biden is the crypto president. If something big is going to happen with crypto, it's going to happen under this guy's watch. Next 4 years, this landscape is going to evolve massively. And it's amazing that we have an administration that could be very favorable to us. So, yeah, Trump literally hates crypto. Trump tweeted that he doesn't like Bitcoin and that it's doo-doo. So, I don't understand a lot of these big Bitcoin proponents or massive Trump supporters too, when he literally said, you know, you talk shit about my bags and I'm never going to forgive you, you know? So if you're a big, you know, Trump guy, I don't know how you can be a big Bitcoiner too. When he's talked shit about your bags and he's done everything in his power to make your bags worthless. And Bitcoin's prospered despite that. If you'll notice, the big Bitcoin rally started after Biden was elected, right? I don't say elected because it's a conspiracy. It's not official yet. But after, you know, it became clear that Biden was going to be the president, well, guess what? Bitcoin went to the moon. Well, why? Well, because that. Anyway, guys, thanks for being here. You know, I know I owe you guys another stream sometime soon. You know, because we didn't have church last Sunday and all that. So maybe tomorrow or the next day, you know, we'll get back in here. I know there's more that we needed to cover. And two, you know, we still got 100 people watching. As we move forward, as I've said before, you know, like somebody said on Twitter, it might have been Bagsy or somebody, who's made you the most money this year? My answer was me. And that's because I do my own research. But you guys are a big part of that research. Value accrual. Solid token economics, primitives, base layers. Let's find them and let's buy them before everybody else does. And let's hold them. See what happens. You know, we're not fucking around. We're not playing ping pong anymore. all the conflicting ideologies with Bitcoin and being a leftist, you know, of course. But at the same time, I do think that the Democrats are more open to innovation, pushing that envelope a little bit. It's not so much the ethos of Bitcoin, you know, which is more conservative. It's more so the regulatory landscape for Bitcoin is more friendly under Democratic rule than conservative rule. But Happy New Year to you all. You know, good health. May you all have a good 2021. And I hope that you all can take a step back and do what I did at the beginning of the stream. It's time to come to terms with your biggest mistakes of 2020. Maybe your biggest mistake was you couldn't help it but getting into all these rugs, you know? And you kept trying to get rich super quick. And so, you know, you bought this rug and you got rugged and you bought this rug. I don't know what your demons are, but it's time to face them. It's time to be better. We've got a new year. This new year could be a really good year for us. Let's make the most of it. You know, figure out what your demons are and conquer them. Move forward. Be better. You know, I certainly fucked up. For every win I made in 2020, I fucked up just as bad somewhere else. So hopefully in 2021, we're going to be better. But thanks for being here, fellas and ladies. Maybe there's girls watching this. Are there any girls watching? I don't know. But that's it. Till next time, adios.